The GOAT featuring Quilly, run it up. Song of the week, $1 million worth of game.
Solar City.
Yeah.
The money be coming and coming and coming and coming and
coming. Money coming.
Gotta add it up, bag it up, stack it up. Gotta add it up, bag it up, stack it up. Gotta add it up, bag it up.
Come on, stack it up.
I'ma be the greatest till they bury me. True definition of a pedigree. Can't hold a candle to me. They can't match my energy. Gotta get it, gotta get it. Doing dirt, dodging prison. Had to take a buzzer, giving. Locking low with precision. Fucking up my mama dishes. Having money with my addiction. Hard hit, I wouldn't listen. Through pain, I learned my lesson. Gymnastics to work out flipping. Don't play baseball, but I'm
pissing.
Now tend to fuck your missus. She bragging about a dick, she missing. New rentals every week, I whip it. New clothes every day, I'm dripping. They killed Davey, was crippin'. Came from that, and that's my ambition. I'm a boss, that's my position. Run the block, good mathematics. Fees gotta jump in acrobatics. Niggas don't want no static. Get hit with a semi-automatic. Channel 6, losing with tragic. Man, you know, viewing close caption. All about the binge and mic gaps. Got a big bag, I'm gon' flex. Bitches see me, they want sex. Niggas mad, I'm up next. They can't rap, no contest. I'm gonna go be honest. See me say, yo, honest. My money forever timeless. The money be coming and coming and coming and coming and coming and
go.
Gotta add it up, bag it up, stack it up.
Yeah.
Gotta
add it up.
Gotta add it up to stack it up. I be sippin' all berry, these niggas just cap'n clutch. I got six bitches in a chop, they gon' lap it up. Bro put up in the Cullinan, why they mad at us?
I'm
no accident, I don't wanna brag. Feel like every day I'm wreck chasing, they don't wanna crash. Pull this 4 pound out, niggas do 100 dash. This is two up top, it's three now, cause that's my other half. Run, Quilly shot, running, taking bubble baths. Left this drum roll with no recoil, it ain't jumping back. Got a turkey butt with monkey nuts, you don't want none of that. I told the line, I'm on cups, he hit me, ain't want nothing back. Hard rock like the cafe, I serve in bag, yay. If my phone only do a dime, then that's a sad day. I'm sipping Waikisha, bitch, this a money bag day.
I told him,
wait, that's too far, nigga, meet me halfway.
Meet me halfway.
The money be coming and coming and coming and coming and coming.
The GO featuring Quilly, man, run it up, man.
Run
song
up,
of the week,
up,
$1 million worth of game, but you ready?
Let's go.
Let's go.
What it do, Lo?
Yeah.
Heard the music, y'all.
Boom, boom, boom. We up in this motherfucker. On some murder, murder.
Come on, baby.
Kill, kill shit. Yeah.
The butcher coming, nigga.
Some real hip hop shit.
Yeah. Murder music just for this type of shit they could ban us. Cause this what they gon' play when they wipe they prints off the hammers. I really like that.
Lord.
I ain't just write this shit for the camera.
Uh-huh.
I did in my city what Michael Vick did in Atlanta. Cash saved for insurance. Them bad days was a forest. Still hood. Roach clips in the ashtrays of my forum. In LA, R&B bitch drunk with her hands around me. The night Swiss introduced me to Nas at a Grammy party. When my strip introduced me to hard, I had grams around me. A star player never asked for the bar, they just playing around me. Niggas heard I took a shot. They was asking if I was good. I looked the shooter right in his eyes when that trigger got pulled.
Murder music, murder music, murder music. Murder music,
yeah,
yeah. Murder music, murder music.
Come on,
murder music.
Yeah. Some come through the water, some come through the border. Some of them get caught, but that's depending on the porter. Old niggas hiding, young niggas sliding. I'm being the man, just protecting and providing. My only concern is if it cook right. My chain yellow, way the diamond set up, it make it look white. Kill you for nothing, cause they petty. Cutting the dog food with the fetty. They young, but they ready. No crowd, I get my applaud off the beats. I'm a boss, so I make sure all of us eat. Say a couple funerals will bring a war to a cease. And remember, it ain't no reward for the streets. This is not normal. Dickie suits is how we dress formal. Where I'm riding his tracks like a porno. Aight then, what's up then? I'm busting every controlled substance. I touched it, I know it's disgusting. I'm just stacking, call me El Guapo. And I bet you never had a brick from El Chapo. Tuesday, I just play the crib and make tacos. A lot of niggas frontin' like they nice, but they not though. Y'all soak that up, now soak that up. They done pulled my coat, nigga, the goat got up. What's up?
Murder music, murder music, murder music. Murder music, yeah. Murder music, murder music.
Come on, Boston.
Murder music, yeah. Murder music, murder music, murder music.
Murder music. Murder music.
Yeah.
Murder
I only music. Got time to murder shit. I bang them while deafening in both ears. Uh-huh. When I'm making niggas black and rip couches and throw chairs. Uh-huh. At times I be unleashing a wrath that most fear. Uh-huh. I don't discriminate. I even body close peers. See, I'm suggesting most you niggas should get to step into the rear. Uh-huh. And fuck with most
this is
you
a
niggas are tall.
Classic
I don't
right here.
Care. Uh-huh. If you don't rep it right, you shouldn't come around here.
Oh no.
Adjust my level up. Make sure when niggas sound clear. They wanna stop and wanna steer.
They do.
They hate that I'm the best and it's greatness in the flesh and it's pointless to compare. Uh-huh. You need to scribe this jewelry and write to save this shit on a server. Uh-huh. And type the way that I speak for moving space on a cursor. I'm not an advocate for violence, but push me, I'ma push it further. The script, hand on my hip, squeezing the grip a little firmer. These dumb niggas don't realize that it's better to be a learner. Stupid nip, when you don't, it's when you get the feeling of burner. Shut the fuck up, it's better to be watchers, listeners, and observers.
Cause if you not,
you fuck around, it's how niggas like you get murdered. Get murdered.
Murder music. Murder music. Murder music. Murder music. Yeah. Murder music. Murder music. Murder music.
Bring it back with the old school scratch. Give me one of the old school scratches for my
murder
band.
Music. Murder music.
Murder music. Oh. Snoop Dogg, a.k.a. the legend, Hall of Famer, Algorithm is coming out, and it's going down, man.
Absolutely.
This shit is going down. There's no games. It's going down. The legend is coming back out. He's fucking shit up again, and he's bringing some of his friends with him, and he's bringing some of his youngins with him. This shit going to be serious, and it's coming out on Def Jam.
Hold on. Yeah. Before we even go any further, we got to get right into this shit. This episode of Million Dollars Worth of Game is brought to you by New Amsterdam Vodka.
New Amsterdam.
Now, New Amsterdam Vodka is distilled 5 times, is filtered 3 times for that clean, crisp finish.
Crisp.
You know, it's great for pre-gaming. You know, if you're watching the NBA right now, you know you're watching the Lakers lose. You're watching the Sixers win.
That's good. Right now.
Oh, no, I just, you know, figured I'll throw that in
there. Yeah, shit, I've been here.
It's October, nigga. You know we don't care about no October wins. Nigga, it's Halloween. Nigga, trick or treat.
But when you watching the games, make sure you get you some New Amsterdam vodka. You know,
get you some of that piece of them niggas over there thumbing through, too. Them niggas over there thumbing through that shit. That nigga stacking that shit with cheese. Go ahead, nephew. Shit, you making that shit look voluptuous.
Absolutely. New Amsterdam vodka and a good pizza, they go right together. You feel what I'm saying?
Who know that?
The official vodka of Barstool Sports and a presenting sponsor of $1 million Worth of Game.
Now. Get your money up.
Let's get into it.
So quick, so fast. It's my pleasure to be here, fellas. I'm all the way out here in Jersey, down the street from Philadelphia.
Yes.
We had a secret location.
Secret.
Giving up some of this game. $1 million worth of game, to be exact.
Absolutely.
So yes.
If you locked and loaded, tune in so you can get you a bar of it.
Yes, sir. Ski.
Snoop.
Mm-hmm.
Came in the game decades ago.
Yes, sir.
Young man. Long Beach, with a dream. I've seen everything that come with this shit. The ups, the downs, the going from broke to having money, to going back fucked up, to getting money back. When you sit back and you look at all the shit you accomplished and where you at right now, today in life, whereas though it seemed like every time I turn on the fucking TV, Snoop is somewhere. Like, you so much of a chameleon out here, you be with gangbangers and Martha Stewart. Mm. Then you walking down the beach giving out Coors Lights to your friends. Bing.
Corona.
Yeah.
Get that ad right.
Yeah. Absolutely. That's a Corona.
Fucking the money up. You fucking the
beach.
Corona's gonna come in when I finish with the Corona deal, so that's cool.
Right. You feel me? You giving Coronas out on the beach. It's just like, you went from being a young rapper from the streets to now you represent so many brands out here and so many walks of life. Like, did you ever think it'd be to this point?
I mean, you can't say that you never did think it would be to this point, but it's just a matter of having imagination. Like, I imaginate a whole lot. I got a lot of imagination on me as far as, like, I dream of shit and I manifest. I was told that I was a manifester, that a lot of things that I bring to life are because I put them in the air, or I make them come to life based off of existing in my mind and feeling like they already exist. So I didn't think that it would be like this, but I knew it would be like this. You know what I'm saying? I knew it would be a position that I could hold in music and entertainment and just do some of the things that the greats before me had done, because I wasn't just into music. I was into the culture. So who was ever the man when I was a young, whether it was Muhammad Ali, Magic Johnson, Richard Pryor, whoever it was, I always like would want to have a piece of each one of them, because they were my icons. They were my heroes when I was young. And when I got the position of being in front of a spotlight, I was like, I want to do what they doing, but to another level, because they could only take it so far because there was so many rules and regulations when they was in the game, and we broke the rules and we made our own regulations.
I respect that, because, you know, at the end of the day, man, you've been through so much. Like, me growing up to your music, you know, I remember when you was fighting the murder charges, and you've been through so much, and then a look and to see that you just got so many corporations that's invested in you, like, to the youth, that's just like a sign, and you know, like, you could do any fucking thing you want to do out here, man.
Right, but see, what they got to understand is there's a professionalism to it as well.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. It's not walking to those offices with a hood mentality. It's walking to those offices with a business mentality.
Right.
But keeping the hood in me at all time, but remaining a businessman. Because you could fuck up opportunity, too. We've watched businessmen bully their way right out of position, or either try to, you know, gangbang their way into a higher position and lose out all the way around.
Right.
This industry respects business. It respects, you know, originality. And that's what I'm about, doing good business and being original about what I'm doing. And I feel like the shit that I went through as far as the losses that I took, they made me stronger and they made me a better businessman for me individually to teach that you got to know the business. It's not who you know, it's what you know. A lot of people feel like if I connect you with this person or I put you in a room with this person, but what are you going to do when you get in that room?
Right.
It's the what you know that's the most important. And once I learned that this is called show business, I had to show down. Ricky Harris, rest in peace, always used to tell me this shit when I was a young rapper. Uh-huh. He was like, Snoop, you got to learn this shit is called show business. You got the show, but you ain't got the business. Uh-huh. And I used to always think about what that meant. And I wanted to practice on my business and making sure my business was strong enough to match my show. So now I feel like my show and my business is at the top of its level that it could be at. So now I could teach, educate, and give information through my examples of either fucking up or doing it right.
At the end of the day, it's like, you know, when we first seen you, right? And I'm going to tell you some real shit that's personal for me, because I was sitting in the penitentiary cell, and it fucked me up when I seen you with Marcia Stewart, because I'm like, yo, man, I grew up off Snoop. I remember he was going to fuck the trial. So to show me that was motivation, me sitting in the prison cell, and like, yo, how the fuck Snoop and Martha Stewart together? And this dude was facing, you know, life in prison. Everything was on the line. So it's like to be able to shift that and say, you know what? Yeah, I went through that. To see that elevation so far and so high, it was like I'm sitting in the prison cell like, yo, everything is possible.
It is. It really is, Wallo, because you got to look at it like this. People are people. No matter what color they are, where they come from, if you sit down and talk to people just like you guys do with y'all podcast, you find out that certain people are really people.
Mm-hmm.
Like when me and Martha got a chance to hang out, we discovered that we love the same things and we have the same beliefs in life. We love to love and we love to teach. And I was looking for somebody like she was looking for somebody. I was looking for a sister, somebody that could help me and navigate me into another world. And she was looking for somebody like me that could help her, you know, diversify herself in this industry. So it was a blessing for both of us to get together. And from that one relationship, we created like a partnership of love to show people that people from any parts of the world can work together, be together, and love each other. And that's the example of it all. It's not even about the money or the business. It's that Martha's from over here. She's a white lady. Snoop Dogg's a black man from over here. How are they together? Don't worry about it. Learn how to be like them, and the world will be a better place.
Just connect. Because one thing I say about you connect with all people, man. You don't discriminate. You just show love to everybody. You show love. You always giving out that ism. you know, since the beginning of time, you always been like that. And it's just a blessing to be still have you around, because, you know, I always talk about some of our legends and how some of our legends, you know, they fell and they're not here with us no more. But to see you still here and thriving, it's just like, it's unbelievable. You see what I'm saying? When you think about Pac and Big, they died so long ago. It was so long ago, but you're one of the people that came out, that was out basically before them and still kept running.
I love this game.
Yes.
I love this shit, for real though. I don't do it for money. I do it for love. Mm-hmm. Like, I really love this shit. I love what I do. Like, on some real shit, I wake up to it. Like, my job is to entertain people and to give people what they want. And I love that shit. Like, I don't know nothing else. I couldn't go work at a department store, at a food spot, or none of that shit. This is what I do. And this is all I do. And I love doing it. And I've grown into understanding mastering myself. And once you learn how to master yourself, everything else comes easy. And I think that's what's wrong with the industry right now. It's too many people trying to be like somebody else instead of mastering themselves. If you could just master yourself and figure out who you are and why God made you, then the world would be a better place, because it would be a bunch of original individuals walking around instead of so many people who sound alike and look alike. And that's no disrespect. That's what all due respect.
Now, November 12th, the album come out. Why did you name it Algorithm?
The reason why I called it Algorithm is because the algorithm is fucked up right now. You got computers and machines telling you what's hot and what's not. When I was making records in the 90s and before I was making records, there were people who told you what was hot and they could feel the records, and it was a feeling that went with records. So my algorithm is to break that computer shit and put feeling back in music so people can feel it and understand it and let people tell you what's hot. Not a fucking computer and not a programmer that's programming every song to sound a fucking like.
Right.
Can you imagine being a kid in the 70s and every song came out sound the same?
Right.
Or growing up in the 80s and every song sounded the same? Or when we came out in the 90s and all of me and Biggie and Tupac all fucking sounded the same?
All had the same.
When it went right.
The beat had the same, you know, tempo.
Listen to Tupac's first album, Biggie's first album, Snoop's first album. It ain't no two things on that motherfucker the same.
Not nothing. The lingo, not nothing.
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 That's hip hop. You can go to Eric B. and Rakim. You can go to Big Daddy Kane. You can go to KRS-One, Roxanne Shanté. You can go to anybody. MC Light, Latifah, anybody. None of they shit mimic nobody. And I'm not saying that's a bad thing. I'm just saying that's what made us more competitive and more, you know, edgier to make that kind of music that's still here today.
Right.
And that's major.
I tell Wallow all the time, you know that. Like, all three of us are like blessed, you know what I'm saying? Because we older men who connect with the youth. Mm-hmm. And one thing the youth don't care about is no old niggas.
Oh boy, we didn't. When we was young, did we?
You feel what
I'm
saying?
Nigga, when you was young, did you give a fuck about an old nigga trying to tell you to slow down?
Absolutely fucking not. You feel what I'm saying? I felt like, nigga, I'm the old you. Shut up, nigga.
Yeah, I whoop you old, nigga. You ain't what you used to be.
Young nigga just told Gil that the other day. I put you in your pockets, nigga. Shut up, nigga.
You ain't what you used to be. Gilly, sit down somewhere.
Shut the fuck down, nigga. I said, Gil, leave that young nigga alone. Leave them young niggas alone, man. Let's keep walking, man.
No, but that's the fact that the youngsters really identify with us because we don't try to cramp their style. Yeah. We let them be who they are. And when we give them information, it's just information. It's not to downplay them. It's to try to help them get above and get further than we did, because we went through certain shit that they're going to go through. So they respect the fact that we could be honest enough to tell them the truth. That's why they call me Uncle Snoop. I didn't ask for that position or that name. I thought I was going to be Snoop Dogg, you know, the rapper forever. But I became Uncle Snoop because of the love and the way that they look up to me, the way that they feel like, this nigga's my uncle. I can come to him for advice, information, love, security, whatever I need, he's going to be there as an uncle. And that's what the thing is now. They call me Uncle Snoop because that's who I am, and that's the spirit that I give off to the young generation.
And because people see it. See you for what you see is what you get. You feel what I'm saying? Because you see Snoop, he be over here doing this thing. He dancing over here. You'll see Snoop at a basketball game dancing. Mm-hmm. You'll see Snoop at he could be at a tennis match. He out there. Yep. You feel what I'm
having
saying?
Fun.
Snoop
having
will be fun. With Matthew McConaughey smoking weed. Yeah, so it's like yep.
When I was
see,
on death row, I couldn't smile. You know what I'm saying? Because we had all this gangster shit that we was rolling with, that we was living.
Yeah.
It was 7 days a week. But when I beat the murder case, I wanted to smile because I was blessed to to have a second opportunity. So I learned how to smile. Right. And that rubbed niggas the wrong way because they wasn't used to seeing a gangster smile.
Right.
They wasn't used to seeing a gangster have fun and unite and organize and be friends with other people.
Right.
They always wanted the gangster just to stay in his own little circle, but I broke that shit and made it cool for gangsters to have friends, to smile, to laugh, to let people talk about them, to be able to accept it and give it. You know what I'm saying? So right. Just breaking the stereotype and making that shit cool. And once it became who I was, it's like, I can't stop doing it. It's who I am 7 days a week.
Do you think if you would have never had your back against the wall and, you know, was facing losing everything that you would have let go that early at an age?
No, I wouldn't have let go. My daddy was in the Vietnam War in 1968, got shot 3 times. I was born in 71. So that's the odds right there. I wasn't supposed to be here. He was supposed to be going in Vietnam. The life expectancy for a black male in 1968 in Vietnam was 16.4 seconds. Did you hear what I just said?
Yeah. Damn.
16.4 seconds. Because for one, they dropped us off first. Then we had to walk on landmines. Then when we walked this way, guess who behind us shooting at us? The white ones from down south that really wasn't with. Remember this 68?
Yeah.
It ain't like it is. And it was like, they was calling us niggas and everything. Martin Luther King had just got killed, all that kind of shit. So we getting shot at from the back and the front and stepping on landmines. And we only got 16.4 seconds to survive. So this is the odds I had to face before I was even born. So I feel like it ain't nothing I can't face. My daddy went through it all, and I was with him when he was going through that. So it only pushed me out to be that who I am now, like that anti-bullshit. You know what I'm saying? Like the Black Panther, the gangbanger, all of the above in one, based off of my father's experience and my mother's experience from Mississippi to California to the shit they had to go through from the 60s to the 70s when I was born to the shit I had to go through watching racism and all of that shit to be able to say that I can change this shit by just putting love in the air. Not change it by saying fuck all of them and let's do what they did to us. But no, let me love them and show them how to love. That's how you change the game.
Now, take it back to the 90s. Rodney King.
Mm.
You and Dre and them, y'all in the studio.
Nuh-uh. Nigga, yep. We went out. I went out.
No, loot, I'm talking about before. I'm talking about when it jumped off.
When it jumped off, nigga, we went out loot, nigga. I stole a TV, a motherfucking couch, a boombox, motherfucking furniture, all kind of shit. Nigga, I laced my apartment up. I had a one-bedroom apartment with no furniture, nigga. After 4/29/1992, I had a whole motherfucking apartment full of shit. The day the niggas took over.
The day the niggas took over.
29/92. I know that day like yesterday, nigga. Hey. April 29th.
But listen, did you know what I know the difference now? Now, Snoop looked back, he said, damn, man, that was fucked up what they did to Rodney King. Back then when he got that sofa and all that, he was like, thank God for Rodney King.
I was happy as a motherfucker because the nigga was still alive. Shit, he got paid like a motherfucker.
But listen, how did it, but how was it? Listen, Snoop.
Rodney took that ass whooping for that couch and that big back TV, nigga.
Hold up. That ain't that shit you be smoking, because I don't be coughing the shit you be smoking.
The fuck out.
That's some serious shit, on.
Yeah, that's that bubble gum.
That's some real shit. That shit you be shit. Having be bullshit, cuz.
Hey, man, the fuck out.
This nigga smoke Reggie.
You gonna put smut on my name?
You smoke Reggie. I'm
in front of him?
I got to. You smoke Reggie, because that shit got me coughing. That shit ain't you got no have me coughing. I walk right through that shit.
Can't put no smut on his name.
No, it ain't no smut. I'm being real.
Hold on. I got a song called Smut on My Name.
Oh, let's go. Let's go. This song.
Hold on.
Take a left on Crip Street.
Good God damn.
Never put a smut up on my name.
Damn.
Ain't nothing funny. Never put a smut up on my name.
Stop smiling cheap.
Never put a smut on my name, nigga.
Twin deep in the motherfucker. Ice got pocket for the heat. Uncut. No smut nigga try to run out. Barbershop cut. Line them up. I line them cook.
Yeah, bosses keep talking and I'm tying them up. Dump that gasoline. Yeah, we find them up. Talking wet, I connect, get your check for respect. It's a promise, not a threat. We on deck in the press.
Folk killers, lines and gorillas, stars and folk fillers, cars and cat fillers, bars and rap fillers. Ignore you rap niggas, you touched up the frame and fucked up the game. God damn, ain't nothing funny. Never put a smile up on my name. Damn, ain't nothing funny. Never put a smile up on my name.
That's right.
Stop smiling.
What's in my bag? I was ready to snap out. I thought I had my chucks on, man. Chill.
Unk throw that shit on. He's screaming out West Side. Nigga from North Philly. Allegheny Avenue.
I had my Pendletons on. Hold. My Cortez Knights. I was in my zone. Now, but this the whole thing. Y'all was in the studio. Y'all heard what's going on. Y'all ran the fuck up out of there, huh?
Well, actually, when it first went down after the when the verdict went down and the riots and shit and all that shit was happening, I was in Long Beach at the homie house and we was watching on the news and the shit that broke out in L.A.
Mm-hmm.
Right, so you got to look at the cities like this. Like I'm from Long Beach, we over here, Long Beach right here. You got to go through Compton, Inglewood, all that shit to get to L.A. So when we jump in the car. We rolling, it ain't no fires in Compton, ain't no fires in just right in L.A. This wall of activity going down. So we jump out, we get cracking, boom, 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 and we heading back to the house. Now it's popping in Compton. We jump out in Compton, get our loot on. Boom, we heading back to Long Beach. Boom, it's popping in Long Beach too. So we collecting shit all the way back till we get to the hood. Now we got three shipments of shit that we didn't collect on that day. But when we get back to Long Beach a week later, somebody tell, just like these rats, they tell and they start knocking on niggas' doors like, anybody, you got any new furniture? Like, nah, like, hold on. Where you get that new TV and that new couch? Nigga, either you under arrest or get that shit up. Niggas start unhooking shit. Nigga, take this shit. I ain't going to jail. Take this shit. I didn't live in Long Beach. I lived in Hollywood. So they didn't knock on my door. Yeah. So all my shit was hell off.
Yeah.
I mean.
Together.
Yeah.
So what we did was when we seen that, we went out looting, and D.O.C. went with us, too. I gave him a shout-out, because that nigga was gangster. He jumped in the car with us.
Mm.
D.O.C. went with us, RBX and the whole crew. Went out, stole shit, came back to the studio the next day. Then we told Drake, nigga, we need to make a song, nigga.
The Day the Niggas Took Over.
The Day the Niggas Took Over. And he was like, all right.
Break them off some.
Yep. And that put that talking in the beginning.
Yeah. With that real talking shit. That was some real shit, that talking.
That was from a director named Matthew McDaniel. He would shoot all of the gangster shit in the hood, and Dre knew how to take like snippets and make that motherfucker feel like a fucking movie when you listen to
that shit. Was a movie,
right?
Like a lot of young cats don't even know about the
break them off something. But I just witnessed the most Snoop Dogg shit you could ever witness in life.
What you say?
That nigga was telling a story. Hunk was telling a story and used three fucking backwards. See this Long Beach right here. this Compton.
I had to let you niggas understand, nigga.
Yeah, you even tell your stories with the weed.
Nigga, y'all niggas ain't got no motherfucking props up here. I got to make this shit work so you niggas can understand what I'm saying.
He showed a half of one that was a little bigger. Yeah, that's that shit.
In the United States, period, point blank. If you ain't down for the ones that suffer in South Africa,
break 'em off some, 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 break 'em off some. I got my finger on the trigger. Some niggas wonder why we living in the city, is do or die. I got my finger on the trigger, so niggas wonder why we living in the city, is do or die.
They really understand. They really, really are they friendly dogs in the comprehend. They not Rodney Peace and we not Rodney King. The gun goes click,
my gun goes bang.
We're riding Compton and we're riding Long Beach. The grinding a finger face, they made it deceased. Niggas does that loot and police start to shoot. Then the color that they clock and they get it like they root. They don't show no luck, so it's us against them.
Say what?
Because they fought to attempt to kill Africa on pink. Till I lay and lay fake, they buy a cake and put it to.
How many niggas is Brett to lose?
Rioting, well, I don't want to say rioting, but there's this looting
break. How many niggas are ready to lose?
What you gonna do? What you wanna do?
I said, how many niggas are ready to lose?
Got myself a Uzi and my brother a nine.
Nobody
told us today, in other words, you're still a slave.
No, right. How much money you get?
Still ain't shit.
Sitting in my father's room, calm and collected. Trying to thank God and get my respected. Cause what I just heard dropped me in half and half. And the brother I know of the niggas on the road is spelling laugh now. But how much later? You said the niggas get together, they get mad.
back cause they can't fade us. Like my niggas from South Central Los Angeles. They found out that they couldn't handle us. Bloods, Crips on the same squad. With the S.A. sons and brothers, it's time to rob the mob. And break the white man off something lovely. I don't like them so they can't love me. Straight getting it down, putting my suit on. The trumpet and the cobbler, so I got to get my loot on. And kind of bought some furniture or something. Got the VCR in the back of my car. And they can fuck a strip, not try to stop me. They think you'll see it, I can't be stopped. Cause I'm a cop and cop and cop till they all drop.
Yeah, yeah, hey, that's that motherfucking that. Work right there.
That's that work
you
right there.
Fuck me up with that, cause I wrote that verse and I had forgot all about
that. That's that shit.
Hold on.
That's that shit.
So you put the pen to that.
Oh yeah.
I wrote that verse right there, the one that just went off, the Dr. Dre verse.
Yeah.
Daz wrote his shit. The reggae shit in the beginning. Mm-hmm. That was Daz.
That was some cold
and
shit.
And how many niggas is ready to loot? I did that. And then RBX was about to come on the second verse.
That was powerful. That's
one
a powerful
time, trigger
song.
Happy no nigga love.
What is your best song ever on Death Row?
My best song ever on Death Row?
Your favorite song out of everybody, not just you, it could be somebody else. Out of your favorite song on Death Row Records?
Probably New York, New York, Corrupt. That nigga was killing that shit. Have you ever listened to the lyrics on New York, New York?
He was going in.
Yes.
That nigga was so barred up on that. And just to know how that song was created. See, what y'all don't know is that song was a St. Ives commercial. That Biggie Smalls ad. That was a Biggie Smalls beat. Yeah. That DJ Pooh had did for Biggie Smalls for the St. Ives commercial. And I heard it, and I was like, that shit banging, cuz let me get that beat. And he was like, it's only a commercial, so we hit Biggie. He was like, he ain't tripping, so we took the beat. And I was gonna rap on it, but I was like, I don't know what to rap about. So I just put the hook on there, New York, New York, cuz it's an old Grandmaster Flash song that I like. So I put that hook on there, and then Corrupt came to the Digital Shack, and that motherfucker started writing that shit. And I only helped him with one line, because he said, it's incredible. It seems like Mimi. It's going to take a miracle, like Niecy. Like Niecy, he thought it was somebody else. He said it was somebody else. I said, no, that's Niecy. And he said, okay, like Niecy, it's going to take a miracle. And that motherfucker just, and when I listen back to his verbs, his style, his cadence, his, do y'all know that that's the only nigga that I rapped against that I couldn't beat, that we tied? That's how I met that nigga.
Yeah.
I met him in a rap battle, Philadelphia's Finest.
Yeah.
And I'm from the LBC, and I don't lose the nigga, so. Yeah. this was some other shit, you know what I'm saying? Like, so just to say that, that was the best song that I ever heard on Death Row Records, because knowing where he came from lyrically and knowing how I put him in the game as far as, like, battling, and brought him to Death Row, and then he made the best song that we ever had on Death Row in my ears and my eyes as far as the lyrical content.
That's cool.
Moving forward, what was your best song on No Limit?
Ride for my niggas. See Murder. I knew it.
Oh, yeah, that's,
you know,
that shit.
That was a Fuck Death Row song.
Yeah?
Yeah, but, you know, we just, Master P was like, he don't do all that, but See Murder, like, fuck that. Fuck them other niggas.
Yeah.
Like, basically, that's what it was.
Right? Damn.
If you listen to it, that's what it was. Listen to this, like, bitch, I'm down with no limit. I'll ride for the cause. I'm the nigga on the tank with the big fucking balls. And if anybody fuck with Snoop Doggy Dogg, I'ma make his niggas put his name on the wall.
Yeah, he went in. See Murder went the fuck in.
Boy, did he?
He went the fuck in. All right.
Free C Murder, nigga.
Free C Murder, nigga.
Now, your best song on Bad Boy.
Mm.
Your favorite Bad Boy song?
My favorite Bad Boy song. Damn. Boom, boom, boom. Make it hot. Boom, 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 boom. The world is filled with pimps and hoes. I'm just talking about those.
Damn,
I know.
I didn't think he was going to pick that one.
That shit's so hot.
What is mine? Can't you see? I'm just trying to be all I can be. What you talking about?
Nigga, what? When I heard that on Biggie album, I was like, oh, that shit's so hard.
Yeah, he was pimping in jail, but that's some other shit.
Oh, he lying on me. Stop the dumb shit. Putting smut on my name.
No, he did. He had a couple hoes.
He put smut on my name. You see what I'm saying?
He had a couple hoes. He had Ricky Minaj.
He putting smut on my home.
Yeah, Ricky Minaj.
Yeah. That nigga put smut on my name.
Yeah, Ricky Minaj. Lil him. Not Lil Kim. Yeah, Lil him.
That nigga put smut on my name, oh.
And he Beyonce.
That nigga put smut on my name. He put smut on my name. Come with the bullshit, nigga.
This episode of $1 Million Worth of Game is brought to you by OCB, Rolling Papers. Now, let me tell you something about OCB, Rolling Papers. It's the shit. Smooth. One of the largest roller paper brands in... No, wait. Is the largest roller paper brand in the world. Not one of them. It's the biggest. You know what I'm saying? One with nature, crafted naturally since 1918. So anything that's been open since that long, it's been in operation since that long, that's over 100 years, you know it got to be the shit. You feel what I'm saying? And now's your chance to join the OCB family forever. OCB Rolling Papers are giving a lifetime supply of rolling papers, cones, and some fresh swag to our loyal fans. Make sure you check out at OCB _USA today for a chance to win. All you got to do is follow at OCB _USA on Instagram, like the OCB High Hall post, and tag two friends in the comments to win. There's a shortcut too. Go to OCBUSA.com/game. OCBUSA.com/game with a link to enter on Instagram now. Must be 21 to buy papers and follow accounts. Good luck. So, you're running Def Jam.
I'm running up numbers at Def Jam.
Running up numbers at Def Jam.
Yeah, like what that means is I'm trying to put some talent in the building. I'm trying to help the people that's over at the building and just restore the feeling of Def Jam, because I'm a big fan of Def Jam Records.
Yes.
I remember when Def Jam Records ran the music industry. Their music was the shit. Their spirit was their shit. The jackets.
The logo is the shit.
Jackets, the logo.
The logo
the
was crazy.
Come on, my nigga. So I'm just a West Coast nigga that love that shit, and I wanted a job over there so I can help restore the feeling. And the first thing I'm doing is putting this record out, Algorithm, which has a lot of classic Def Jam artists on it, and then has a lot of new artists from Def Jam. And then it's got some friends of mine on there as well. So I just wanted to come and do sort of kind of like what Khaled is doing. You know, Khaled is doing a great job of, you know, doing the compilation albums and putting that talent out there and, you know, being a spotlight to the talent. So I just wanted to come compliment the industry and do what I do and just break the algorithm by putting out some music that feel good and not just sound good.
And I remember one time when Def Jam was going hard on the West when he got Warren. They got a bunch, didn't
Montel Jordan. This is how we do. You know, that's a Def Jam record.
Yeah, wasn't Dove Shack on Def
Jam? Dove Shack, Dove C, Richie Rich.
Yep, you had a bunch of people from West Coast. They was on there heavy in the 90s.
It was Def Jam West.
Yep, Def Jam West was heavy in the 90s. But a lot of people don't know that Def Jam had like everybody. Jay, Murder, Inc., Ruff, everybody was over there.
Man, to be on Def Jam Records was a dream come true.
It was.
Like, if there wasn't no Def Row Records, I damn sure would have been on Def Jam. Right. Warren G got a chance to make it to Def
Jam
Records.
Yes, he did.
And when he went to Def Jam Records, he changed the whole shape of the building. He saved their ass, actually, financially.
Yes, he did.
You know what I'm saying? It's documented.
I read that on Russell Simmons' books.
Yeah.
Sex, Life of Death.
Yeah, because Russell was a real nigga. He going to tell it like it is.
He broke that shit down.
And not like it was. You know, get credit where credit is due.
Yes, he did.
You know, but at the same time, it's like, that's how much we love that building. We love Def Jam. We love what it stands for. We love the originals. You know, the fucking Slick Rick, Beastie Boys, Public Enemy, LL Cool J,
EPMD. No, Run DMC was on Profile.
Yeah,
it wasn't,
you know,
on Def Jam.
That shit, the origins of that shit that
Public
made us,
Enemy.
Yes, that made us
greatest
want to do
albums.
It.
Public Enemy.
Come on, man, the Bomb Squad, Hank Shockley, and
everybody was over there.
Man, I'm gonna do some music with Hank Shockley. I met him about a month ago.
He's a legend.
I told him, I said, "Cuz, let's work together, cuz I just want to see what it's gonna sound like."
Let me ask you a question.
Of your shit.
At that time, I can't even ask you this. You gonna pick Hank or Dre? Is they neck and neck?
They tied.
Thank you.
Because what Hank was doing for the East is what Dre was doing for the West, and I feel like they shit was so similar, but it wasn't. Because Hank would take samples, he would
this
take
shit
certain,
was crazy.
He would make the brothers and sisters. I don't know
his
what
sample
this
game was crazy.
Just like Dre's was.
I mean, this,
let's I'm keep it 1,000.
Yeah, they would sample up.
And
they would sample
did,
kings.
Where did Ice Cube go when he left Dre?
He went right to Hank.
And what did shit sound like?
His shit went to another level. Okay, America's
then.
Most Wanted.
Okay,
Hank
then.
Hank Shockley did all Public Enemy shit. He did Ice Cube first shit. If you
Preach.
Don't know, he's a fucking legend.
Preach.
This dude is a... I'm talking about... Think
Preach.
About Welcome to the Terror Dome.
Preach.
Don't believe the hype.
Terminator
the
X.
Terminator X. All that shit. And then you just think about all the Ice Cube first shit. Hank is a fucking legend. Shout out to Hank. And Chuck D is one of my favorite rappers of all time. He's a legend. If I see Chuck D, I might pass the fuck
Wait,
out.
Hold on, fuck this. I gotta take this opportunity. Because one thing, I grew up playing basketball. We all know that. I started rapping later in life. It just so happened fast for me. But obviously these two are fucking hip hop historians.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So
yeah, I'm a legend.
We gonna see who know the most shit.
Come on.
You got to ask Snoop three questions. He got to ask you three questions. Whoever get the most right is the hip hop historian.
I got you.
All right, you finished the rhyme. You can ask me any question, but you finish this rhyme.
Let me see where you going.
They call me C-Loke. The G that ain't no joke. The mystery of mass with the killer Snoop rap flow. See us.
You called me slipping on that one. You got me. You up one.
Nigga.
What was that?
That's Steady Dipping. Bloods and Crips.
I didn't fuck with that album because Battle Cat had the blood side banging harder than the Crip side.
That Pyru Love.
Yeah.
That killed
shit,
the game.
Yeah, that shit was
Pyru
hard.
Pyru Love. That killed the game.
See, this is what y'all didn't know. Out on the West, we didn't fuck with that album because Battle Cat had the blood side banging harder than the Crip side.
No, it was
harder than the Crip side. All they songs.
Steady Dipping was.
That one didn't make a difference. Once the world got on the streets, niggas like, oh, hold on, cuz. Why they side banging harder than ours? And that's when the shit was like. The riots hadn't happened yet, so it wasn't really no peace in the hood. That project was pre.
Okay, that was beforehand.
Yes.
Oh shit.
They was dissing on that project.
Oh, so they was. Yeah,
that
was
wasn't no like, hey man, we're Bloods and Crips. It was like calling niggas out of their name. Nigga.
Yeah, all that other shit. Yeah. All
right. Well, no. Well, okay. Well, listen. You got to ask another question.
Yeah, give me something else. I'm gonna ask you a question. Who was the first rapper?
Ho, I get 1 point, right?
Yeah, you got one.
He
got
1 point. Get 1 point.
Fuck you, man. I asked him about Bloods. This is a legendary album.
I was supposed to know that.
Banging on Wax was a legendary album.
I was supposed to know that.
Banging on Wax was a legendary album.
That's you can't ask about a nigga that was dissing him. I ain't listening to this shit.
I still was supposed to know that.
He was supposed to know that. That was Banging on Wax.
That's the point. I was supposed to know that. You right. You motherfucking right. Who was the first rapper to actually get on the microphone from New York?
Oh, my God. It wasn't Grandmaster Cass?
No. Hollywood.
All right, so you got me. He got me, damn.
Big, big, big is 1-1.
That's 1-1. All right.
I just can't let Snoop get you out of here with no fucking wins because I'm not going to not hear about
this. Round two. Ice Snoop. All right.
Round two.
All right. Who had a song called Rhyme Pace? Listen, DJ Quick, Too Short, Richie Rich, Rapping Forte.
Rhyme Pace.
No, Pace Style.
Oh, because Ryan Pace is Ice-T. Yeah, that's Ice-T.
Pace Style.
Yeah, because that's Ice-T.
Pace Style.
Oh, yeah, he fucked you up. You said Rob
Pace. I said Pace Style. My fault. Pace Style.
You said Richie Rich. You said Forte.
I said Richie Rich, Forte, DJ Quick, Too Short.
Page Styles. Because freestyles is the
that's free shit. It. They don't do that shit on
so
the West.
Somebody was cool. Trying to get paid. I'm going to go with Too Short.
He got me.
Oh, he fucked you.
Because he's a pimp, man. He's trying to get paid.
He fucked you over. Right, shoot him what? Come on, Oak. Let's go, Oak. Don't let him get the fuck out of here.
Okay, I got to get you a good one right here. Who was the rapper that Fresh Prince battled in the 80s from Philly and lost to?
Nigga, if you don't know this if you don't know this nigga, I'm gonna slap the shit out.
Don't help
him.
In the 80s from Philly.
And he lost to him.
Schoolie D.
No, nigga.
Yeah, who?
Steady B, motherfucker.
Oh,
fuck out of here.
I forgot even what.
Fuck out of here, nigga. It's over now. That's it.
Damn,
I quit. I retired.
I fucked your shoulder.
Listen, I retired,
fuck
nigga. I retired. That nigga didn't know that.
How
the fuck he gonna ask you a fool got a nigga from Philly?
Philly question.
And you fucked up. Like, I wasn't even rooting for you until he went to Philly. God damn.
But I beat anybody else. It's my first time. I beat Shaq.
You beat Shaq. You beat Funk Flex. And now you lost to Snoop, so Snoop
you better
is
know
the story.
Now, hip-hop, it was set out in the dark. We used to do it out in the park. You know what I'm talking about?
Snoop the real historian, nigga.
Now.
Fuck you gonna look. He confused. Look at his face. He fucked
you know what
up.
I'm gonna do though? While I'm gonna tie you into this thing, I'm doing Russell Simmons. We doing an NFT for all of the original rappers, the ones who started
Let's
in the beginning
it.
That didn't get no fame and didn't get no money. We created NFTs for them, and they all going to get paid off of it. So I'm going to tie you into it with me.
Do that. We're going to make it happen, man.
You can be a part
all
of this
legends,
history,
like,
man.
It's a lot. You know what's crazy? I told a young rapper this shit the other day. He was talking about, he's like, man, I supposed to be getting more money. And we was on a phone call. He's popular. Everybody know this motherfucker. I said, let me tell you something, nephew. Be thankful for your blessings. Mm. I said, you know why I said this? I said, you run around getting 30s and 40s a night. You getting paid more than Tupac and Biggie was getting, nigga. Mm. Like I said, what is you tripping about?
We was getting 15 a night back then.
Y'all niggas was on cover of the Rolling Stone getting 15.
The nigga was happy. My first 100,000 came from St. Ives from a commercial.
You never got 100,000 for a show back then.
My first 100,000 came from St. Ives Beer Company for a commercial I did. You hear me? Remember when Ice Cube said, I told all my friends, don't drink eight balls because St. Ives is giving in. That was for real.
They gave you 100 bands.
100. And Suge got mad and went and got 200. And I had a blue Suburban. He went and got him a red one.
Damn. So publishing checks. When was the first time you seen a publishing check?
What is that?
Ooh.
You mean my first couple of years? What is that? Publishing? You mean I wrote all the deep cover? I wrote all the G thing? I wrote all the Dre Day? I wrote 70% of the Chronic? Wrote all damn near 80% of Doggy Style? Wrote 70% of Warren G album? Wrote 50% of Dog Pound album? Wrote 60% of Murder Was a Case? And what is a publishing check? We don't know what that is.
Damn.
I'm Snoop Dogg. I'm the hottest nigga in the world. Fuck publishing. What is that?
That's crazy. That was crazy.
And still ain't got it.
They ain't give you no way.
The deal I was signed to a publishing company called, look on the back of the Chronic album. You can probably pull it up right now. It's called Nothing Going On But Fucking Publishing. I'm not making this shit up.
And when we just, every time that song, none of that shit, you get.
What? Only time I get paid is when I perform.
God damn.
But all that other shit, if you hear it, see it, nope. But it really don't get looked, it don't get, really get a look like that. You don't really hear Death Row Records in movies, TV shows, endorsed. You don't hear
that
shit.
They don't get synced like that.
No. Not really so. It's just collecting off of, you know, history and people that just classically buy the record. It just probably sell a certain amount every year or whatnot, but it don't move my pockets.
When did you learn about, like where in the game, where was you at artist-wise when you first learned, like, this shit is important, publishing?
No Limit. Master P gave me a lesson on all of this shit. Like, sat me down and explained everything, and he took me to Louisiana. We drove around the neighborhood. Said, pick out the house you like. Picked out the house I like. Had the paperwork. That's the first thing that was in my name ever. Took me to the dealership with me and my wife. C-Murder drove us down there. Picked out a truck for me. Picked out one for her in my name. First car is in my name. Account. Here's your accountant. This is your accountant. This is what they do. They take care of your business. They take care of your taxes. They pay your bills. Okay, I didn't know all that. I just thought niggas just put money in the shoebox under the bed and live like that. Structure, business. You gotta invest, real estate. This nigga had a mall. This nigga had a whole mall when I was on No Limit. Had gas stations. This nigga had different money. The shit that was showing me, like, okay, I gotta think different when I get back to LA. I can't just buy shit and not invest in shit. So P showed me, like, the business, like I was explaining to you earlier, it's called show business. Death Row told me the show. P showed me the business.
Let me ask you a question, okay? So you mentioned that, you know, Death Row don't really get no looks and, you know, the movies, but it's a lot of fucking hits over there.
Imagine if Snoop Dogg was running it.
I know. Do you think it's like that because of the energy that surrounded Death Row?
I think it should be in Snoop Dogg's hands. I think all of Death Row should be in my hands. I should be running that shit just like I'm in position at Def Jam. Death Row means more to me because I helped create that.
Right.
I think they should give me that, let me run that shit, put the merchandise out, put the music all over the world.
Oh, my God.
Find some new acts, some new West Coast acts, because there's so many acts. Just look at it like this. If they'd have gave it to me 5 years ago, I would have had Roddy Ricch, Ty Dolla $ign, YG, anything coming out the West would have been on Death Row.
Right.
Tell me I'm lying.
You ain't.
Tell me I'm lying.
I mean, you connected, so they can't say you're lying.
If I'm running Death Row Records, and all them little niggas need a deal, and they all my nephews, not in all, I fucked with them all before they had deals.
Right.
If I had a position, this would have been an easy, come on in.
Layup.
You up under the logo.
Right.
Who is administrator? Like, who running Death Row, right? And what company
Death Row was bought by E1, and then E1 sold to a company called Blackstone. So Blackstone has Death Row and E1 right now. But, you know, Lil Birdie told me that it may fly my way soon.
Yeah. That's going to be, it's going to be unbelievable. So.
Like I told you, I'm a manifestor. I got to push shit.
You got to.
Wait, that was the bird.
So everything that's over there, the Chronic is over there, Doggy Style over there.
Tupac is over there.
Tupac is over there. Dog Pound is over there. Lady of Rage over there.
Murder Was the Case Danny is Boy, over there.
Every, Above the Rim soundtrack.
Above the Rim, Poetic Justice. What's the other movie Tupac was in where he was with Belushi?
Oh, yeah, the cop joint.
That one over there.
Machiavelli over there.
Machiavelli over there.
God damn.
It's heat over there. It's heat.
That's one of the greatest catalogs in the history of rap.
It's heat over there. It's a lot of heat over there, and it's not being handled right. But like I say, a little birdie told me that it may fly my way, and if it do, you'll get it, everything that I told you.
The relaunch of Death Row Records.
If I can get Def Jam popping, what could I do with Death Row? Just imagine that.
A catalog, yeah.
I mean, it's going to be a lot easier because people, you know, when they think of Snoop,
they think of Death Row. Right?
Yes.
I'm one of the legs to the table. You know, you got to have four legs to build a table.
Right.
I'm one of them legs.
Dre, another leg.
Exactly. Sugar's another leg. And Michael Harris is another leg.
Yes.
Because he put up the finances. Those four legs right there started Death Row Records.
Shout out to Michael Harris. He home now.
Yes, sir.
Harry O.
We got some business. We got Boss Player, Unfinished Business. We created a company together called Boss Angeles. Be on the lookout for a lot of projects that we're doing together. That's why that music is necessary for the shit that I got lined up and playing.
Shout out to the OG, man.
Yes, sir.
Harry O.
And a shout out to the homeboy 50 Cent, too.
Okay, 50.
Yeah, man, shout out to 50.
This nigga is killing TV right now.
Hey, listen, man.
He deserves his flowers for just taking a network, making that motherfucker his, and making every nigga in the world tune in every Sunday night. From, we used to watch HBO. We used to watch all The Wire and all kind of shit on other networks. Tell me I'm lying. Niggas is locked in on Sundays. Nigga, the stars. 5-0 got it on lock. That's right. My nigga.
We Shout see you on there. See, God got you.
Pastor Swift.
Pastor Swift.
Swift. I'm going to keep it all the way. Some Swift game.
Listen, Swift look like he on some Swifty shit, too.
Yeah.
Yeah, me.
I run Swift, a side hustle on the side.
Swift look like, because the way he was eyeing, you know, Mama, you know what I mean?
Mama was eyeing me. Other way around, man. It's pimping,
he all
man.
In that bad house talking. It'd be nice if I get a little dinner. I'm like, wait, hold on, so pastor, on, man. You taking this shit?
That's how the pastors was back in them days, man. They was real friendly. You did?
Yes, they was.
Liable to wake up with that nigga on the couch, like, what are you still doing here?
Yep. Mom's tired.
The pastor was tired. I put a blanket around and he on
Fetty,
the couch.
I gave him the big piece of chicken, baby.
Damn, show ass out here, Rebel.
Nigga named Pastor Pillow.
Nigga that rolled a J up and everything in the motherfucker house. He got the reefer in the tray and the ashtray and all that shit.
Pastor Pillow.
nigga that smoked, got the big piece of chicken gravy all on his shirt and shit.
That's player shit, though. We gotta commend him, though, because.
Yes, you do.
When you get that position coming out of rap, like I like to say, when you diversify your portfolio, 50 is going to be a legend in rap forever. His records, his music, his movie, his shit he did to just change the whole game of New York and just run New York for a minute and put that New York spirit back in the game. Like, fuck you, niggas. He did that. To leave that, to jump off into the TV world after, like, not having such a successful movie world is amazing.
Absolutely.
Because he figured that shit out. Absolutely. He got that shit on lock. And I'm a student right now. I'm trying to learn from him. And it's true. You can teach an old dog a new trick. That's if he's willing to listen.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm studying him as well. You know what I mean? Because the shit that he's doing is remarkable.
And we actors, nigga. You know that.
Yeah, absolutely. So
to see what he's doing with those niggas, he's breaking niggas and giving niggas like
opportunities.
And they becoming stars.
Absolutely. Yep.
Nigga wanted to beat Tariq up in real life. They thought he was really the nigga.
Absolutely.
Nigga like, hey, nigga, this is a movie, a TV show, like, nigga.
Nigga, you kill ghosts.
Yeah.
You know, and what's so crazy is, to me, right, you know, a person's legacy, you know, is also tied to, you know, how many people did he reach down and pulled out the water. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, for Big Meech and his whole family to be going through what they going through, and, you know, he go and get his son and make it happen for his son, that's some real shit. You know what I mean?
Niggas don't do that.
And that's a million points in the hood. That's a million points. You don't get a million points in the hood. That's a million. To save a man's son.
Absolutely.
Give him a life and then tell your story at the same time through his life. Man, that's God.
Absolutely.
Yeah, that's major. Sitting back in the penitentiary, seeing this shit all come to life. you know, you written off when you in the pen. So to boy, see that.
Boy, you know it better than anybody.
Yeah, nigga, you written the fuck off, especially when you doing big numbers.
Nigga, stop writing it.
Everybody forget about you, man.
All that.
Motherfuckers, you know, all that. Oh, this, you know, this, then the third, boom. Oh, no, listen, motherfuckers forget about you in the joint. And on that note, it's time for
Stories from the Cell.
Damn.
Listen, man.
I hate hearing that cell.
Listen, yeah. You damn, remember that joint.
You just reminded the nigga. Motherfucking 9,500.
Well, when that thing first slammed on you.
Nigga had to pull his pants up and get real tough then. Like, nigga, all that smiling shit over with.
Yes, it is.
Shannon, nigga, what up? What's up, guy?
What's
up, nigga?
When they first slammed
that cell, nigga, I'm a different nigga. What's happening? What's up, Wallo?
You gotta be.
So, what's up, nigga? Give me a cigarette, nigga.
Now, if Wallo was going to L.A. County and I just walked in there, where do I go at? Do I go to Civilian or do I go to Beans? Do I'm not from over there? What cage do I go to?
You go to Civilians. You go with the regular people because you don't want to be, you know what I'm saying, misclassified with the wrong organization because you're out of town, nigga, so you cool with everybody. So you don't blood or cuz. You just from out of town because you don't want to get caught into a mixer where they feel like you one or the other. You want to be.
Wait. So in L.A. jails.
We give out of town pass.
No. But shit. But they don't just place people anywhere.
It's called classification. They ask you questions before you get to where you get into. What city you from? What gang are you from? And if I'm not in a gang. Well, they'll classify you by the city that you live in. If you say, for example, if I live in a blood neighborhood and I say I don't bang, they're not going to put me in a crip cell. They're going to put me more or less with regular people, or it's going to be a few bloods in there. Mm. That's what the classification is about. When you say I'm from out of town, I'm from Philly, they know, okay, he can go anywhere because he ain't a gangbanger. Mm. But you just can't get caught up with saying cuz of blood. Because that classifies you as a gangbanger in jail.
Right. Well, when I was in, you remember Colors, right?
Right.
I probably could play one of the characters. You remember Main Man, you remember OG Bobby Johnson when he was in Colors? No, not that one.
Oh, you mean when he was Rocket?
When he was Rocket in Colors.
No, he was High Top.
High Top, and he was playing both sides. He was
a blood and a crip.
He was a blood. I got a confession, Snoop. It'd been times when I'd been in L.A. and I was in the wrong area, and I was whatever the area.
Oh, so you was High Top.
I was High Top. I told Gil about that. I said, man, I was whoever the fuck area I was in. I got a confession. I'm just being real. So if
this
I go
nigga
there,
is a real life High Top.
So if I go to the county, I don't know which. I think I'm gonna go to where it's over the most people at. So if it's
well, if you watch Colors, one thing you know your ass better not do is lift weights.
I'm not going to do that. I'm going to post up.
That's when they caught High Top.
They caught High Top and fucked him up.
That's your ass, High Top.
They whooped his ass. They whooped his ass in there.
He was High Top in jail, too.
The fuck out of here.
If the Muslims was winning the fight, he was in there. Salaam alaikum! Allahu Akbar! If the Christians was winning, he was just
now, listen,
Jesus
I'm gonna be
loves
up,
me.
I'm going to be straight up, though.
He was High Top in jail, too.
At the end of the day.
Rotten ass nigga.
I know how to navigate through life. Yeah. It's called navigating through life. High Top. You know how to navigate through life. So if I'm in L.A.
Man, High Top died in the prison yard, am I right?
No, he got fucked up in the prison yard.
He didn't navigate
through life.
He didn't die. He made it out.
He was a hustler, too. He was getting money.
He was.
He had the package. He was over here selling them the package over here. So he was a package man.
No, he was a nigga who thought he was slick, and then they caught that ass.
No.
But niggas was doing, the cold thing was, that wasn't a movie. That was the truth. Niggas was doing that when the Dope Game popped out, because it was the Dope Game was so fresh and new. You had niggas who was just trying to get the dope, and they didn't give a fuck who they got it from.
Yeah.
So if he could come over there with a blue khaki suit on and sell you some dope, you wouldn't ask no question. Be like, nigga, I seen you over there with the bloods over. You just trying to get the dope and keep it moving.
Right.
And until he got locked up is when the word got out. Because, see, behind the wall is where everything is ran from the streets. Yeah. That's what niggas didn't understand. If you really pay attention to the movie, behind the wall is what runs the streets.
Blood in, blood out.
Every movie that you see that's based on West Coast culture, that penitentiary or that jail cell dictates what happens on them streets.
So the big homie is really in the joint.
They still shot calling. But now, if you make a movie nowadays, that shit out the window. Little niggas running shit. They don't give a fuck about none of you old niggas, none of y'all. Just like you just said.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Like, that's what the young nigga told another
day. Unless you, they uncle or they big homie that they respect. Other than that, fuck that.
I'll put money to their pocket.
We writing our own rules the way y'all did.
Right.
Now you going to tell me how to write my rules when y'all did?
Yes.
Absolutely. This episode of Million Dollars Worth of Game is brought to you by Lightboxer.
Lightboxer.
Now, if you see me at the crib, at the studio house, you see me working on a Lightboxer all the time because it's a great workout. You feel what I'm saying?
You still talking about how you beat me
that I did. I worked your ass out, too. And Lightboxer makes workouts, you know, fun and competitive. It's licensing, so you get all the newest music from Justin Bieber, Post Malone, The Weeknd, DMX.
Everybody.
Not everybody, but a lot of people. You feel me? And a team of gamers and DJs program punch sequences for each song. So, you know, you just working out as it's showing you what the punch. You check me out on Instagram, too, because, you know, Lightboxer. I'm going to be showing y'all how I work personally.
Yes.
So every workout and song is unique and challenging. Difficulty options for each skill level, so it don't matter what level you on. You feel me? That don't matter. And you don't even realize how hard you're working until the workout is over because it's a bunch of fucking fun. So when you want to be in shape and learn how to punch and, you know, work out and, you know, burn some calories like I do, go to lightboxer.com/game and get $200 off your purchase or use the code GAME at checkout to get $200 off your purchase. Right.
Welcome to another episode of $1 Million Worth of Game Business Spotlight, where we bring to you people that's out here making it happen from the community that's going to give you $1 million worth of game so you can make some paper out here. Today, we got my man.
King of Airbnbs.
And a lot of people got a beef to, you know, a lot of people got a bone to pick with you, man, because you did something for your wife and you put a lot of pressure on a lot of dudes out here. Yes, but that's another story. We're going to get to that later. But we got my man, the king of Airbnb, Zoda Goat, here, Mr. Zoda Goat on Instagram. You can also go to MrZodaGoat.com. Listen, man.
Legend.
Airbnb, I'm going to keep it real. Killing him. I'm talking about, listen, he managed and owned over 112. I'm talking about over 112 Airbnbs. He managed and owned them. Like, this dude know what he doing, man. I'm talking about he know what he doing. He's on here $1 million worth of game to get y'all some games so y'all get into the Airbnb game. Talk to me, Zoe.
With just $4,000 or $5,000.
You don't even need that much.
You don't need that much to get in the Airbnb business. And the thing about it, you know, I specialize in theme units. So I add that value inside of the unit to charge a higher premium price.
When you say theme units,
he's talking
about
them illusion loons. Them units that you go there, you can think it's your crib for a minute. It's just magical. Got all type of shit up in there.
Like, yeah, so far as theme, like, I tell people honestly, don't have your personal feelings involved. Cause a lot of things make me money that I don't like a Barbie thing, of all pink unit. I ain't gonna do my house like that, but I do an Airbnb because I know females like that. They're gonna pay that $500, $600 per night, and stay there, you know, running it up.
So what's some of the most unthinkable units that you got? You got the Barbie theme.
Got the Barbie theme. I got a royalty theme. I got a sugar factory thing we just did. All, you know, all candy.
So it's all candy in the whole crib.
All candy in the whole thing.
So it's like, I'm talking about, and anybody could do this. If you got anybody to come through your course, they could get up on here and they could go and design their stuff anyway. They could get the game from you on how to design this shit.
How to design it. And the crazy thing about this is it's passive. So I tell people all the time, it's like, if you want to, you know, get to that wealth, you know, build up that passive, because you can run your Airbnb from anywhere in the world. Yeah. You know, I was in Dubai the other week and I'm still making the same amount of money from my Airbnbs, you know, so I teach people on how you can have that and control it from your cell phone.
No, because you ain't got to tell us it's passive. You get money because you just, like, first of all, you messed the game. You fucked the game up, Zoe.
Yes,
you
did.
You on your wife's birthday, you're going to get Skittles. Shout out to Skittles. You're going to get her, what was it? You got her, was it a Lambo and a Rolls Royce?
I bought a Lamborghini truck and a Rolls Royce.
Like,
on the same day.
On the same day. Private jetted her people in there, all off of Airbnb money. Yeah. You're gonna get that right.
And then also we had a private party inside the private airport when she landed from the private jet.
See, now you're putting, that's pressure.
So, right. So you just spent $1 million weekends, huh,
on your birthday. He's spending his Airbnb money to just flex for wifey, and then you putting pressure on other cats that's out here that's like, they can't even, listen, Lamborghini, they can't even spell Lamborghini. Some people can't even spell Lamborghini. It's too costly.
I can't spell it. Fuck you talking about?
I can, but that's another story. That's another story. I was ready to get you. But go ahead.
But living this lifestyle, like, I tell people, like, if you want your bank account or your life to be massive, you got to do stuff that's passive. Now you can scale up even quicker, you know. So I was always an entrepreneur for my whole entire life. Since I was 19, started my first business. But I didn't always make money passive. But when I started making money passive and I tapped in and, you know, credit and the other things, I was able to scale up and live a whole nother life I always dreamed of, you know. I ain't go to college. I only got a high school education, you know. So I just had to focus on things that's gonna take me to the next level. And I understand about wealthy people, they got two things in common. All of them got good credit, and all of them make money while they sleep. They make that passive income. So, you know, just tapping in on that.
And just the whole thing, man, coming out of South Carolina, man, he just had bigger dreams than anybody. He said, man, I ain't about where I'm from. No, I'm going to turn it up. I'm going to come up out of South Carolina. I got a dream. I'm going to bet on myself, and we're going to take this thing to the next level. And hold up. While you right there, you see this number right here. Text this number on the screen right now.
Text that number.
Text this number to get up in this course and get this $1 million worth of game from Mr. Zo the Goat. I'm telling you, man.
And make sure you text Zo the Goat.
Make sure you
text Mr. Zo the Goat.
Make sure you text that right here in this number. But we're going to get back to this. So you got all these themes, because I wouldn't even think nobody would have a Barbie Airbnb. That's the last shit in my mind. I'm thinking the only place you go see some shit like that is one of these amusement parks or some shit like that.
I mean, not only that, with the Barbie Airbnbs, like, I tapped in and I figured, like, how a way to make more money than I was making before. Like, a normal person who got an Airbnb, who got a two-bedroom unit, they probably have 2 to 3 beds inside the Airbnb. I figured out a way on how I can have 8 beds inside of a two-bedroom apartment. Like, I have 3 twin beds in one room, 1 queen bed in another room, and then 3 or 4 pull-out beds in the closet. So now I can charge a higher premium price, because people traveling with 7 or 8 people, guess what? They all can bust down the price $100 a head per person, and pay $600 a night, you know, especially on the weekends.
So damn, that's a come up right there. I ain't know you could do that off a twin size bed. That's like the size of joints we had in the prison. Yeah. Hey, twin joints. So you getting 100 for a twin?
You still sleep on a twin, nigga?
No, I don't do that. You know what I mean? Sometimes I do got a little twin air mattress that I pull out just for flashback reasons.
This person, nigga, he got his little ass humble bed.
That's to stay humble. You got to just remind yourself where you came from to stay humble. That's a humble sleep.
Man, you can get a queen size bed, man. Fuck is you talking about?
No, you talking about
that. Bed, your feet hanging all off there, and I'm like, this nigga got money.
You gotta understand what's going on. You gotta understand the dark side. So I'm just reminding myself of the dark side. But for him telling me that, I'm like, hold up, I can take my bed and throw it up in somewhere and Airbnb that shit out. That's major, man. The twin size, that's jail beds, man.
Yeah, absolutely.
But so, all right, now what other themes do you have that's like out there?
I got the pink, I got a white and gold, I got a blue and gold, I got an all red one. When they walk in, got the throne chairs, the black throne chairs, and it's painted all red. See, one thing about me, I really get busy. Like, a lot of people, a lot of my units, I don't necessarily own it. Like, I control it. Like, they my Airbnbs, I have the lease, but I don't own the property. But the good thing about it is that I'm able to go in and I got a vision. I go in and revamp the whole entire Airbnb. Yeah. So I'm not afraid to paint the walls, paint the ceilings, paint the counters, because I know that's an investment that's going to make me money. So I tell people, when you get in this business, if you got the money to go overboard, you definitely gonna get overpaid when you go overboard and invest inside your Airbnb. So
okay, how many Airbnbs do you own?
Me personally, I have 51. But far that as all of that, yeah, all 51, right.
Mm-hmm. But all together, plus the ones you manage, because people, see, if I'm out here and I'm watching this, I'm sitting on the couch right now, charging, I'm whatever, and I got 3-4 Airbnbs, and I ain't got shit going on with them, I could reach out to Mr. Zo the Goat,
yeah,
and you're going to say, all right, give me that shit, I got this, and you're going to make it breakdance.
Of course, make you breakdance. And then all you got to do is sit back and collect money. I'm managing, I'm doing all the work. Somebody calls me at 2 a.m. saying the toilet not working. We handling that. You sitting back, collect the money, you know, while we taking care of your property.
That's major. So is it hard? Like, if I'm a regular guy, I got a little spot. Is it hard to get into the Airbnb system?
No, it's not hard at all. Like, you only need a couple dollars. And if you ain't got a couple dollars, I tell people, use your credits. Because some people got good credit, but they don't know how to use it. I say, use your credit, because, for example, right now, a lot of people don't know, you can go to Wells Fargo right now and get the active cash card. And they got a promotion going on with 15 months with 0% APR. So that means you won't pay no interest for the 15 months. But I got a lot of students that's able to get their return back in Airbnb in a month, or at the latest 3 or 4 months, they're able to get their return back. So you can use the bank's money, buy everything, the furniture, the couch, even get your money order for certain places, so you don't come out of the pocket paying nothing for your Airbnb.
That's major. So this stuff is not like, this is rocket science. This don't take a lot. It's just, you got to be able to get up in there. That's if you want to go to the next level and put the theme thing that you got going on. But you educate people in your course of how to do themes. Do you give up theme ideas or stuff like that?
Yes, of course. So we have a private group in my course, like a couple hundred students, like 300-400 students, growing every single day.
So every day you teaching?
Right, teaching. So
every day you be having 300-400 students in your class?
We have a private group. So I already have the class that's already pre-recorded, so they can watch it on their own leisure, like on their own time. So I'm in the private group. So after the class, if they need anything, they can come in a group.
They get on the call every day.
Right. So it's basically a private group where we messaging each other, you know, if anybody.
And how do they get a part of that?
Go to my website or you go to my Instagram and click the link.
So sign up for my Instagram right here. Right. And the website is
www.MrZoDaGoat.com.
MrZoDaGoat.com.
So you go there. And how much is the course?
The course right now is on sale for $597.
You know, the course?
Yeah, because I want our people, I want to make it so the average person can afford it. So that, you know, they can be able to help their family be able to become wealthy. Because I know with one unit, that can take you to two units, take you to four units, take you to eight units. You got a theme Airbnb, you can easily make, in a certain city, you can make $7,000, $8,000 a month profit.
Yeah.
You know, so a good month, $10,000 a month profit.
Yeah.
Because you charge them for photo shoots, you charge them for people who want to do videos, content. So you're able to make, you're able to make way more money than somebody else doing Airbnb.
What is it about, is most of your Airbnbs in Atlanta?
Yeah, most of them in Atlanta.
And they just be smoking.
Atlanta's a hot market. You know, when everything shut down about a year ago during the pandemic, Atlanta was the only city that really stayed open. You know, so to me, you know, the film going there, you know, everything is the new Mecca for us. So I'm investing where the money at. And I tell people, I got students that stay in North Carolina, that stay in Texas, but they got Airbnbs in Atlanta and they don't even go to their Airbnbs because it runs on its own.
Yeah.
You know.
That's crazy. That's deep, man. Like, so all right, I sign up. I get on your course. What all I'm getting?
You get in the class, you get the most important thing, you get in the private group. Because you're not lost after the class.
So it'd be you in there, but it also might be
you got other Big Mike from Texas, right?
And he drops some jewels on me.
Of course.
And then Keisha from Tampa drops some jewels on me.
Right.
Then Vicky from South Carolina, she drops some jewels on me.
Yeah, because you need that, because the business, you know, regulations, restrictions change, and every city is totally different. So I tell people, like, focus on a theme unit, because places like New York, where it's maybe different than Atlanta, you probably can't do an Airbnb as easy in New York, but guess what? You still can have a theme unit and put it on Peer Space and still charge $150, $200 per hour renting out for a photo shoot.
What's Peer Space?
Peer Space is an app like Airbnb, but versus you renting it out for a day, they can rent it out for an hour. So a lot of people want to shoot content. So matter of fact, you can put this on Peer Space and put it for $300 an hour and make $3,000 a day. Somebody come in and book it for the whole entire day. You know,
that ain't bad. Peer Space. Yeah. Okay, so anybody that's doing Airbnbs, or you ain't even got to have an Airbnb. It could be something else.
Yeah, you can just have a theme unit, or I got people on Peer Space, a regular warehouse, and they charging, you know, $75 an hour just to rent just a small warehouse room. You know,
that's major. So at the end of the day, no matter what, you're going to get your money back in that month. You basically
right.
saying,
of course, you can get your money back if you do it right. Get your money back in that month, at the latest 4 months, if you do it right. Even a normal Airbnb, you can get your return back.
So if I'm doing it in Atlanta, say I live in Philly, I want to get one in Atlanta, you're going to give me the whole game. Do you find a unit for me, or would you recommend a unit? You find the contractors?
Yeah, so that's an outside service. I have a private Airbnb-friendly list, because a lot of places, not a lot, but a good bit of places, you can't do Airbnb because they have, you know, HOA or whatever. So I do have a private list, and only in Atlanta, Georgia, where you can pay for that private list, and I give you the property that you can go in there and do Airbnb. You don't have to worry about the leasing office complaining, saying, take this down. What you doing? We don't like Airbnb. So I do offer that for, you know.
So that's major. So basically, though, hey, they're going to walk you through this thing. They're going to be there and support. And how long do you stay on that private group? How long did that go?
I'm in a daily. We've been in there for.
No. I'm just saying, if I sign up today, and I'm Kev from Brooklyn, I sign up today, you know, how long can I stay in this group?
I mean, you can stay in the NFL for his lifetime. You know, it's all about building wealth. You know, it's not just me be wealthy.
It's major.
Yeah, I want all our people to be wealthy.
So you created a whole base and a whole team of people that's just going to keep giving you game. Someone might change. Oh, damn, let me get on the call today. Let me get on there. Let me get in this group today. Let me text. Damn, all I got to do is ask a question in this mass text.
And then it's all type of information being thrown around. No, I got three Airbnbs in Houston, man. That shit popping down there, man. Y'all might want to try to go down there. You know, so it's just because no advice is like the advice of when you got a bunch of people that know what they talking about and they trading game.
Right.
That's the best room you could possibly be in.
But you know, the thing about it is, Gilly, is like, I tell people all the time, like my homies always say, like, if you want to change your conversation, you got to change your conversation.
Absolutely.
So you be in these private groups, you be in the room, you're gonna learn so much that you never learned before. You know Absolutely. What I'm saying? Like even today, where like when I was in the airport, I was in the you know, American Express private airport lounge. You know, people talking to me because they know if I'm in there, I'm in the right room.
Absolutely.
You know, American Express private lounge. Where they join at?
Right here in Philly.
Was at the airport, nigga. Fuck you mean?
No, you act like you've been up in there. You don't know.
I've been in there, nigga. Fuck is you talking about? Just because I ain't never been in there with you. You was locked up for 20 years. Fuck you mean? We walk past them bitches every time we go into the airport.
Right across from A14.
Private lounge. You don't never notice that shit.
What's going on in the private lounge?
Everything goes down.
Niggas with money in there, man.
He said, that's like the DM. He said, everything do go down. Everything going down in the DM. I'm not saying that he married man, but he said, everything. I'm like, oh,
see, you can't tell them nigga did 20 years.
I'm like, he got strippers in there some shit. He said, anything. Oh, what the fuck am I missing? I don't know. But at the end of the day, it's just like, damn, that shit, man. Whew, this bull, man, making it happen. So what you need to do is see that number on the screen, text that number on the screen, Mr. Zodigo, get at him. Listen, I'm telling you what's going to happen. What's going to happen is this. You're going to reach out. You're going to connect with him. And for
$5.97 right now. Might take the price back up, but.
For $5.97 right now. You can get into, you're going to get, I'm telling you, you can get a shitload of resources. You're going to find out how to set you up. You're going to walk you through that. Then you're just going to have a team of people, hundreds of people that is going to be access to you to get information from to keep adding value to what you're doing. And it might add value to some other shit. Because I know people ain't just on there talking about Airbnbs. You might slide into some other game.
Talking about the credit. We're talking about crypto. We got a crypto class coming up tomorrow, you know, and when they purchase it, it didn't say nothing about crypto. You got Airbnb Masterclass. But I throw these classes in there because the knowledge is going to change our whole generation.
So you got hundreds of students. He already taught. He got hundreds of students that he already taught. He putting this thing down. Mrs. Zodigo, what you need to do is you got to go to MrsZodigo.com. Also, follow him on Instagram because he's got the juice.
You see that? See all the information right there. We providing information for motherfuckers to change their life, man.
Change your life.
Don't just go get the course and then get to the finish line and trip, scrape your chin up and don't fast pass the finish line, man.
You got
to
keep going.
Keep going, man. Keep going. Get the knowledge, invest in yourself, and make it happen. That's the only difference between.
Take action. You got to take that action, too.
Got to take the action,
man. Got to take that action.
Got to take the action, man.
Take that action. Make it happen. Listen, right now, once again, so y'all won't get this confused, look at the next text the number, text the information on the screen, but also follow Mr. Zoe the GOAT on Instagram and go to MrZodigo.com. Get this game. You keep talking. We giving y'all $1 million worth of game. Zoe came through and give you $1 million worth of game. Right. You see what I'm saying? Listen, matter of fact, he spent $1 million in one day on his wifey birthday, so you know he got the game. Mm-hmm. That was like over $1 million, wasn't it?
I ain't even added up yet, bro.
Man, he getting money. He ain't fucking added up. You buying Lamborghinis and Rolls Royces and getting private jets and renting the whole private jet, the whole landing strip and all this other shit. You getting money. $1 million worth of game. Mr. Zoe the GOAT. Listen, this is another business spotlight on $1 million worth of game. Get the game right now, and it's just like that.
Now let me ask you this, Snoop, because you know you be having, you know, youngins from, you know, different areas who be, you know, they be gang banging, and you know I don't really be understanding, you know, it from some aspects. So I want to ask you, did you have a choice whether you was going to be a Blood or a Crip, or you was raised in a Crip neighborhood, so that's what it was?
I'm from Long Beach. It ain't nothing but Crips in Long Beach. We the only Crip city. So, Crip or die. That's it. And I didn't have to join a gang because there's a lot of people from my city that didn't join a gang. I chose to because it was fun. It was family. It was the homies. They was hustling. They was getting money. They dressed right. They had the bitches. They had conversation. They had cars. I like that shit. You know what I'm saying? I didn't have a father at the house. My mama did a great job by herself, but them niggas was way more influential. Right. And it was easy to get the shit that they had. I had a job at Lucky's, nigga, going to work 5 days a week, making $84 a week. My homie was standing outside one night. That nigga showed me like $3,000. I was like, nigga, I made this shit today.
What'd you do with your first $85? The first time you got your paycheck at Lucky's?
He bought some weed. He might have did.
He might have bought a sandwich.
I wasn't even smoking back then.
Oh, you weren't smoking back then?
What you treated yourself to?
Nigga, I ain't treat myself to shit, nigga. I probably had money for school. I was in high school. So it was about being able to buy lunch and, you know, look cool at school. You know, a nigga with $30, $40 in his pocket in the 80s in high school look cool.
You had the Cortez Nikes on the chucks. All that
Cortez, nigga.
That's right. White with the blue stripe.
And doing
you said like
thing.
He disrespected you. We wear the shit out some Chucks.
You wore them Chucks.
Nah, he got Chucks on now. He's like,
yeah, but the Chucks came when I became like gang active.
Oh, okay.
Before I was like Cortez, the Chucks didn't come until I became like really a drug dealer, really from the set, really getting into fights, really getting robbed, really shooting at niggas, really getting shot at, like, okay, these motherfuckers is doable. They, any proof, like, fight proof, run proof, shoot proof, you know what I'm saying? These motherfuckers is everything.
Yeah, but they had your feet, they had your tootsies tender.
Not
man.
Me. My shit, this gang affiliate. Oh, yeah, nigga. Yeah,
yeah. Snoop now, got how the many, different feet.
Well, when you jumped on the block, right?
That nigga played some basketball and some Chucks. His and shit put was up money. Bleeding.
Yeah, my shit was bleeding.
I put up money, nigga.
My shit was bleeding. My dogs was a little raw.
I put up
after
money.
After the joint. But I'm going to ask you a question. It's an interesting question because I've been trying to do some research. Like, when you first got into the game, how many blocks? What was the longest amount of blocks that you got chased before?
Blocks, I got chased.
Yeah, because, hey, you got to run from niggas sometime.
Or the cops.
I ain't talking about the cops. I'm talking about the, you know, I'm talking about shit I didn't.
I ran a couple of times. The furthest I probably ran was when I was standing out front and my homeboy C-Dog, rest in peace, he came over there with a nigga from Hoover. And Hoover niggas don't like O's, and I'm from 20s. So this is a big old buff nigga. We standing out there, and I ain't really peeping. I'm kind of like still a square. But a nigga like sizing me up, and I ain't even knowing it. Nigga like, where you from? I'm like, 20s. I'm like, I'm from 20s. I'm saying it all happy and joyful and shit.
I'm from 20s.
This nigga got a bottle in his hand. Nigga hit me in the head with the bottle. Boom.
You broke.
I bone out.
How many blocks you ran?
About three. I was like, I know
it's
that
crazy,
nigga.
It's crazy, man. I ran about six before.
I'm
that's
like,
cool.
I know this nigga can't catch me now.
I'm that's three, cool.
I turned around and look, nigga, my hand started swelling up like a rhinoceros. Nigga, that motherfucker was like, thank you.
He broke. He said,
I came back about 2 hours later. Now I was walking ginger as a motherfucker trying to make sure that nigga wasn't nowhere around there. I ain't want no get back, none of that shit.
That's how I was. I ain't trying to get back.
Hey, tell him your story.
Listen, so one time we was at a party, right? Nigga, you know, he slid me. I took a little nap, right? So when I take a nap, right? I take a nap, I get up, right? When I get up, right? And then nigga slide me. I'm talking about one of them smooth joints.
Right? He didn't slide you.
He hit the, listen, he slid
that
me.
Nigga
he sucker punched
you so hard.
But he sucker punched
it
me.
It sounded like a fucking 25 one off, man.
Listen, he's, bam.
That's just him.
Listen, so listen, I go down, right?
Niggas was ducking.
Down goes Frank. I go down, right? When I wake up, they don't understand. I wake up like, listen, where that nigga at? Oh, he left. Bet. I'm glad. I was happy. I was trying to identify his location so I could go the other way because I wasn't trying to get busy with him. So I know what you say. You ain't with no fucking get back.
None.
That's the game of life. See, nigga, you got to know when to hold him, know when to fold him, know when to walk away, know when to run.
Say that.
You got to know when to retreat. I retreated, man.
Say that. Kenny I mean, Rogers said that, nigga.
Didn't he? That was smart. Snoop said, he said, oh, where this nigga at? He said, I was all square. No,
three blocks
20s.
Up the street, nigga was back like.
you had your head wrapped up.
No, when he said his shit started growing like a rhinoceros.
You had your head wrapped up.
Nigga, I had nothing on my head. My shit was just growing, nigga. I was running down the street. You know, adrenaline and all that shit make this. My shit was growing fast, nigga.
Let me ask you a question. Right?
Oh, man. This nigga.
Because you know it's different types of runs, though. Did he slap you into the run, or was you oblivious of it, and you took the whole bottle like...
I didn't even know he was swinging on me. When he hit me with that motherfucking bottle, my instincts was, get out of here before he do something else.
You...
Hey, everybody got that fight or flight in them, right? Sometimes you got to be the deer, and sometimes you got to be the lion.
Absolutely.
That day I chose to be motherfucking Rudolph. Nigga, I was out.
Nigga, I was Rudolph my whole life. Nigga, I was trying to be. It's too much shit being a lion.
Absolutely.
Niggas get killed being a lion, man.
Shit.
I know a lot of lions that got killed. All the deers I know, them
Rudolph
niggas still living.
The red nose
all
rain.
The deers I know, they still living.
He was a deer.
We here. Think about this
and
shit.
And if you ever
be lions,
saw
you know?
Him running up out of his clothes.
That was me. I was front. He got a gun. As I was coming, oh, soon as the nigga say he got a gun. What?
That's why you still here, man. You got that fight or flight.
We was deers, man. The deers run the worst, man.
Same way in the prison. He got a knife.
No, I played it cool. Even though I was scared, I played it cool.
See,
that's when the self talk comes.
Running through the cell like Fred Flintstone.
No, listen. No, that's when the self talk comes.
Let me tell you something.
No, listen.
They called me from up the jail, right?
You're lying.
No, they, you know I'm not
lying.
Lying
on me.
They called me from up the jail, right? Because you know I had a couple homies that was on the block with him. They tell me, why he Wallow never come to the yard like that? He come to the yard whole time. Wallow out there, he keep looking over. Fuck he keep looking over here for? It's this little dark skin nigga keep looking over there.
Wallow. Oh, yeah, that was a the moment.
Fuck he keep, why the fuck? Darcy nigga come up out his, start running Wallow away. He was looking at the nigga that was standing in the back of Wallow. So, Wallow running through the yard, guard.
Listen, man. No, fuck that. I'm gonna tell y'all some real shit though.
That nigga said guard.
No, I ran. I ain't say guard.
Big fella, it's too late. You finna get stabbed with this stick.
I'm gonna tell you some
guard.
I'm gonna tell you. I'm gonna listen, no bullshit. I'm going to tell y'all some real shit, man. Some real live shit. This episode of $1 Million Worth of Game is brought to you by Roman Swipes. One thing about Roman Swipes, they'll get you in the game if you're not. If you're a bench player, if you're a goddess, you know, you're just a water boy in her life. And she's saying to you, like, listen, you're not ready to get in the game because every time I let you in the game, you don't perform.
What?
You never be, listen, you don't never get player of the game.
What?
You don't get triple doubles. You don't get a touchdown.
What?
You don't get a goal. You don't do nothing. You know why? Because you're not using Roman Swipes. One thing about Roman Swipes, listen, they're discreet. They're straight to the point.
Clinically
I'm talking about clinically approved, fast accident. You don't need no prescription.
None.
You don't need no prescription. But all you got to do is rip it open, wipe it on, whip it.
Let it dry.
And make her fly. That's all you got to do with Roman Swipes. That's what's so great about Roman Swipes. The performance, your performance will be historical. It'll be memorable. I'm talking about this legendary. Your jersey will wind up in the rafters. If
in your bedroom.
Yeah, yeah, in your bedroom, you know, in her mind too. If you use Roman,
because or the it's hotel keep you, room, if yeah, it's not your, woman.
It's going to keep you strong and lasting long. What you need to do is you need to go to getroman.com/game. Get your first month of swipes for just $5. Go to getroman.com/game and get your first month. I'm talking about your first month of Roman swipes for just $5. What are you waiting for? Get in the game. Stop being a bench player. Get your name and your jersey in the rafters. We gonna take it to the top.
Stories.
Now watch this.
Cell.
I'm in a prison yard, right?
Yeah.
I ain't never tell nobody this shit, man.
Oh shit.
So I'm chilling. I'm by the ice cream joint because you know they had ice cream in the motherfucking in the yard and shit. You could buy the tickets and shit off a commissary. Go out there and get ice cream. So I'm standing there. I'm waiting for one of my OGs to come so I kick it with him this time because I had some tickets for him. Gay boy slide up, right?
Uh-huh.
Wow. An old school one, though.
Mm-hmm. Tough one.
No, not just tough. They old school, got the hair laid down, all that shit, right? So, I'm standing there, right?
Well, he pinch your ass.
No. I'm standing there. Right?
Me and this Snoop motherfucker, ain't judging
listen,
you, man.
Snoop, this motherfucker like 50-something, right?
This the part where you're supposed to run.
No. Like, I'm not paying attention. I'm not paying attention. But the mother, listen, and I don't even know if I was violated today. I don't know if that was the day when my innocence was taken from me. Because the motherfucker said, there's no bullshit. I ain't never gonna tell you this. I'm gonna tell Oak, man, because I ain't got no problem being straight up. So I see him walking towards me like the ice, because I was like standing there because I was ready to grab something, but I was like, I don't know.
Can't be eating no ice cream with Cub walking up right
now. No.
That ain't a good
I was ready to grab one, right?
Licking on ice cream with him walking up?
No, he wasn't. I was ready to buy one.
With his hair waxed down.
No, listen. I was ready to buy one. And it was one of them older, you know what I mean? So he, you know, no discriminating about nobody. The motherfucker fucked my whole life up that day. I went back in the cell and I thought it was over for
me. What happened?
He said, oh, excuse me, cutie. Wow. It was over for me. I was done. I thought I was like, oh, shit.
You was like, I'm cute. Oh my God.
No, listen, I was cute. So listen.
You on the radar, girl.
I'm young. I'm like, oh, my shit.
You on their radar,
so listen, girl. So listen. I don't know what to say. I ain't tell none of the homies no shit like this. Because they had roasted me. So I'm like, damn. So I slide away from the ice cream joint and start walking the track, rethinking life. I'm like, why did I do this? Why did I want to be a real nigga in the streets? Why did I want to come to jail? Straight up. I'm thinking about this shit. Because I'm like, everything is on the line. I'm thinking my cheeks and everything on the line. I don't know. I don't know what's going on. Because this motherfucker was like...
Old school. He like that nigga Fleece Johnson.
Yeah, old school motherfucker.
Because booty was more important than a drink of water.
Yeah.
He
was a booty warrior.
Because see, like, if this had been 4 or 5 years ago, I might have would have touched one of y'all's booty.
I seen that on CNBC.
So it was
that
like,
nigga was cold.
It was like, damn, I never forgot that night. I was like, damn, man. I don't think I'm going back home the same. Because he was like, I was violated. Like, because the motherfucker called me cutie.
Excuse me, cutie. The conversation was a violation.
I'm like, that's what I'm saying.
But what see, that's what say? That's what
come. I didn't say no problem. I got the fuck out.
But that's what
I got the fuck
with,
out of Dodge.
That's what come with being behind the sale.
Yeah,
this is all the things that come with being a real nigga, like you said. These are the consequences that come with it. You got to deal with all of that when you behind that sale. You ain't got no bodyguards. You ain't got no homies.
You ain't got no gun.
It's man on man, and if this man like you, and he's stronger than you and tougher than you,
I'll call you cutie.
Hello. We may not see you the same way when we see you again.
Right. I'm just saying. You sat here and told us that long ass story, but you never told us what you said at the
end. I didn't say nothing. I got all the dodge. I hit the track.
He said, hey, cutie. You said,
I hit the track.
Oh, excuse me. I'm sorry.
Oh, did you lick your ice cream after he said
I didn't
that?
I didn't want no ice cream. I was scared. I didn't get nothing. I just walked away because I was trying to buy something.
Was it an ice cream cone or was it a big stick?
It was never one of them. It was a freeze pop,
you,
man.
You licked the ice cream cone.
They probably had big sticks in there for the motherfuckers to be imitating shit.
Listen, man.
They got big sticks tonight. Today is Tuesday. Big stick Tuesdays.
I'm going to say this. Like, the shit changed for me that day, man. I just was a little. I stayed away from the ice cream truck, though.
But you know what's crazy, though? I got a story damn near like that, but not really.
Go ahead. Break
when
it down.
When I was locked up. It was a gay dude in there, right? And one of the dudes that was a gangbanger was disrespecting him, calling him all out his name and shit. Then when they finally got into an environment where it was just them, the gay dude whooped his motherfucking ass. He whooped his ass. The nigga had a new respect, like, okay, you can't disrespect no man or no person.
No.
No matter what their preference is as far as what their sex preference is. A man is a man. He'll beat your motherfucking ass, and he whooped his ass.
See,
that's it what can it, happen.
That would have happened to you.
You took any ass whoopings?
No, I didn't take none. No.
Only on the streets. I'll
and that was stories from the cell.
Get in that cell, nigga.
Well, listen, man, we got On Care November 12th.
November 12th.
Can I play one more?
Yes, oh, you can.
Shit.
This one right here is Fabulous Davies.
Oh, what?
Oh, Lord.
Yeah, it's produced by High Tech. It's called Make a Lot of
High
Money.
High Tech, a legend. High Tech used to do shit for Talib Kweli and them.
Yeah.
He's a legend.
He's mad he lost that. No,
I am fucked up. I lost that joint. Philly. And I lost it to Philly.
Don't worry about it. Make a lot of money. Check this out.
Make a lot of money.
So what you trying to do, nigga?
What all the strips are saying?
Make some money. I'm trying to make a lot of money.
What all my niggas saying?
Make some money. Say I'm that. Trying to make a lot of money.
Yeah.
The money, saw my hoe with a trick and told her make the money. If it's growing on trees, I'm trying to rake the money. Up the heat for the cake, I'm trying to bake the money.
Back in showtime, I get lake of money. No more square feet, I get acre money. I got hate your money, I try to snake your money. And my OG say they act fake or funny when you
hey,
you know the strip are saying
hey,
and all my niggas saying
say that.
And everybody like get your money like
East, what up, though?
It ain't no question we work. More stress than a referee shirt. Go to the spots where we was raised, guaranteed you see dirt.
East!
Round course of break, I ain't spit a cheap verse.
Nah.
A nigga never spit a cheap verse. Like a mic drop for the night, it's all on pepper. Jeff Hamilton stitching the game on my lever. Products falling all out my pocket, too much to measure.
Come on,
I ain't missing the dollars, so back up full of action.
What all the strippers saying? What all my niggas saying? Stick to the script, trip, get chips and dip and just
make some money.
Chips and dip.
I'm a young two gun, two come to a nigga had to. Yeah. I'm willing to dealing and chilling, Def Jam in the building. We came to
Def Jam in the building. We came to make some money.
What all the strips are saying?
Make some money. I'm trying to make a lot of money.
What you trying to
make some money?
What you trying to
make a lot of money?
Uh-huh.
Make some money.
What you trying to
make a lot of money?
Uh-huh.
Make some money.
Ow! Yes, sir.
We make some money, man.
That's That's what we doing.
Once again,
$1 million worth of game, man.
November 12th. Hold
Algorithm.
On. Hold, give it to him.
Algorithm, November 12th. Def Jam is the label.
Yeah.
That's the label. We want to get this right.
Yes, sir.
Now, who all is on the album?
The album has features from Redman, Method Man, Usher, Eric Bellinger, Mary J. Blige, Larry June.
Larry June.
Fuck.
San Francisco Slim.
Benny the Butcher, Jenny Gibbs, Busta Rhymes, Ty Dolla Sign, August 08, YK Osiris.
Fabulous.
Fabulous. Shit. Battle Loco. Wiz Khalifa, D Smoke. Oh, yeah, my new group, Mount Westmore. We just dropped our single.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Shout out
to E40, Too Short. The Legends.
Yes, sir. We ain't fucking around, man. This record is full of heat. It's an algorithm thing, man. It's just records from everywhere. Like, I just put together something that feels good to everybody and anybody. You know what I'm saying? It's something for the East, the West, the South, even some shit for the people overseas, some global shit. You know what I'm talking about?
Absolutely.
That's what is going down, man. You need to get my artist on there, Penitentiary Wild Thing.
I do.
I got a, that's him, Penitentiary Wild Thing. You'd have been a wild thing in the penitentiary, nigga.
I like that song that, the one with that your nephew and him was doing that you was popping a video for a while.
Oh, yeah, that's my son.
That's his son right there, Mac and Cheese, nigga.
What's the song?
Ignore.
Ignore.
That shit was hot.
That's what's up, man.
That shit, I liked it, the dance moves, the whole shit. That shit was hot as fuck.
Yeah, that's what's up, man. Appreciate it.
We got to get that cracking. Hold up.
I fuck with that. Yeah, bang that one time for me, cuz. I fuck with that record.
Absolutely.
I like the step y'all had when y'all told the bitch. Ignore it, bitch. That's my
cousin. Absolutely.
Answer my motherfucking phone. Bitch, leave me alone, bitch. I'm doing $1 million worth of game right now. Leave me alone, bitch. I'm ignoring your ass. Yeah, what are you calling me for?
Well, mac and cheese. Talk about it.
Yeah, double bitch.
Double day wet like water. Y'all did that.
Double day wet like water. Hey, got what you need, place your order.
Here we go. Watch how that shit drop, man. Watch how that shit drop.
Show me how it go. Show me how it go.
Hey, my diamonds they wet like water. Got what you need, place your order. More green than a forest. Used to put the rock like the forest. I've up in the foreign out floor. Nigga get fly like a tourist. She steady hit me up, I ignore it. Ain't about the money, I ignore it. My diamonds, they wet like water. Got what you need, place your order. More green than a forest. Used to put the rock like a forest. Hop up in the four and I floor.
Yeah.
Nigga get fly like a tourist.
Yeah.
She steady hit me up, I ignore it. Ain't about the money, I ignore
it. This callback.
Ain't got no cash, I ain't answering. Nigga, come on, don't get that shit, it was damaging. Come in and party, we can get hammers in.
Crazy get
changed on the mannequin. Nigga, then pop out. If it's up, nigga, we leaving you stuck. But Desi, you bringing them blocks out. Put a dime on your head, don't think you get fucked. We more like nothing at all. We got a let's get it.
Yes.
That's in the foreign, the cause of the flow. These bitches be fishing, trying to jump on the boat. Keep that bitch up my wheel, cause she doing the most.
The play on my face when the nigga was broke.
Tell you ran up that bag. Cheddar be making a mad. I got this shit off the jack.
Fast.
We gotta get to the racks. Run up your head in your head. Run up your shit and go spread. My diamonds, they wet like water.
Got what you need, place your order. More brain than a forest. Used to put the rock like a forest. Hop up in the foreign off floor. Need to get fly like a tourist. She still hit me up, I ignore it. Ain't about the money, I ignore it. My diamonds, they wet like water. Got what you need, place your order. More green than a forest. Used to put the rock like a fort. Hop up in the foreign off floor. Nigga get fly like a tourist. She steady hit me up, I ignore it. Ain't about the money, I ignore it.
Hey. I've been by my paper, so feel like a waiter. My bitch don't need makeup, your bitch want me data. Oh, I can't save her. If she don't wanna fuck, I don't make her.
I've been ballin', ain't got time to lay her. On the block all night, I done stay her. If you owe a nigga, then you better pay her.
And we run our city, no mayor. These diamonds and pussy get soaking. They know that I'm gifted, they say that I'm chosen. Put a stick in it, but it's not poking. Won't give up slipping, I keep my eyes open. We spin this block night, slump like a dope fiend. I know some killers, my niggas got trophies. Niggas be telling these niggas be police. Niggas be hating, they don't even know me. Young nigga bout to take off, I ain't Jimmy. Tryna make a wish come true like Timmy. In my city, young niggas ride around with a semi. Tryna get rich or die, tryna like 50. And my nigga just cop the drum on 50. Hit the nigga up, make him bop like Diddy. And they face gon' frown when I whip in a Bentley. And they know we the hottest youngins in the city.
Yeah.
Got what you need, place your order.
Yeah.
More green than the forest.
You should put the rock like a Ford.
Make sure y'all go download, stream.
That shit hot.
That ignore.
That's that young nigga shit that I fuck with right there. I like when young niggas come with shit like that. That's like
good energy.
Got a whole good energy to it. They got their little step to it. They move, dance. Like, I fuck with that.
Right.
And they telling the bitch to, it ain't about money, I'm ignoring your ass. I'm about this money, man.
I'm fucking right. Mac and cheese.
Mac and cheese, man. It's going down, man. This is $1 million worth of game. November 12th, algorithm, right? Go get that shit, man. This is some solid shit that's coming out, man. Yeah. Def Jam, it's
this
a label.
This is like a Def Jam rebirth.
Uncle Snoop.
Can I hit y'all with some R&B shit before I leave?
Oh, yes, you can.
Y'all gotta know it ain't just rap shit on
here. Yes, you can.
Oh, come on.
There's some R&B shit on here, too, man. So just, you know, so the people will know that we do got R&B shit coming, too. This is Jane Hancock right here.
Jane Hancock.
I hope you enjoy the music you're listening to. It's brought to you by Def Jam Records and yours truly. That's right, you inside of this algorithm. And I want to hear something from Miss Jane Hancock. Let's go.
Sweet shit, that good shit, that hood shit.
Def Jam is a label.
Come on, man, we ain't playing. You better know it.
Def Jam is the label. November 12th.
Yes, sir.
Algorithm.
Go get it. Quit playing.
Uncle Snoop.
Hey, man, thank y'all, man. It's always a pleasure and a treat when playing.
Always a pleasure.
Man.
$1 million worth of game.
Man, we appreciate you just being so, you know, trill about it, man. Coming on, man. And, you know, honestly, just living your truths, because when you live your truths, you know, and the youth get to see you say, man, I didn't know shit about, you know what I'm saying, publishing. And, you know, I had to learn the hard way. And that just make them want to get up on their game more. And they understand that, damn, I'm able to make mistakes and still win in life. Because some people make mistakes and they think that shit over with.
Shit, if you don't know how to lose, you ain't going to know how to win.
Absolutely. And the bottom line is mistakes is just, in every lesson is a blessing.
Right.
And you just supposed to correct with the mistakes you made and keep moving so you don't have less speed bumps to go over in life. So we just appreciate you, man.
Yes.
For being a legend that you are, man.
Give your flowers now.
Give your flowers now, man, because you in like a class of your own. You know what I'm saying? It can't even be like he a rapper, because you do so much shit.
Undefinable.
You feel what I'm saying?
He's undefinable.
That's a great word. That's a great word. You know what I mean? And you just show, you know, niggas like me, man, that the opportunities are endless. You know what I'm saying? Like, we just signed with WME. You feel what I'm saying?
Yes, so, sir. Shout out to Ari Emanuel.
You know, so for us, it's like, we see the shit you doing. We see the fun you have in doing it. Mm-hmm. That's really living life. You know what I'm saying? But you keeping it your way, but you keeping it professional.
At all times.
And that shit just special, man. And we just want to just commend you and tell you, man, keep being great, man. You on so many Hall of Fames, not just the Rap Hall of Fame. You and it's so many different. You can't even put a class on that shit.
Mm-hmm.
What, you got something else?
Yeah, I want to play this record that that Nipsey Hussle wrote for me.
Ooh.
It's on my album called Kool-Aid. I dropped it maybe about 5 or 6 years ago. When did Kool-Aid come out?
2015.
Yeah.
Yo, so me,
it was me, Nip, and Jess Blaze was in the studio. And cuz they gave me the hook and he wrote the first verse. And when I listened to the song, I'm like, damn, this shit is dope as fuck. The shit that he wrote for me and the way I'm spitting this shit. And y'all just made me feel like I got to play it.
Absolutely.
This will be the last one. It's called 10 Toes. 10 Toes Down.
R.I.P. the Nip.
Yes, sir.
R.I.P. the Nip.
Written by the homeboy. Nip the Crip.
A nigga like me, man. I love the game. I love the hustle. Be feeling like one of them ball-playing niggas, you know? Like Bird, Magic, or something. Yeah, you know, a nigga got dope. A nigga could leave to leave. But if I leave,
still
the fans still gonna love me, man.
Rest in peace, Nip.
Rest in peace.
That was
to
a board,
Nip.
Nigga. Yeah. My style is undetectable.
I just said you undefinable.
But that nigga said my style was undetectable. That's heavy, man. That's a bar.
That's a real bar.
You can't find his style no matter what you try to.
How long it took him to write that verse when y'all was in the studio?
20 minutes. He already knew what he knew what he wanted from me. He knew that. Then he told me what to do on the second verse. Then he told me how to start the third verse. I'm like, write the second verse. He's like, nah, cuz, you should write the second verse. But start it like this. Then on the third verse, say this. Say what? Do anybody in the house remember when it wasn't no Snoop Dogg? Hell yeah. It wasn't no rappers hollering about LBC. Am I tripping, y'all? Hell no. I'm like, all right, cool.
Yeah. Absolutely.
You know,
man,
how it is when you're in the lab. You just be vibing. You know what I'm saying? Everybody be giving up ideas. That's why I like being in the studio with a lot of people, because there's always somebody in the corner of the room has some dope ass shit.
Mm-hmm.
What you say?
Mm-hmm.
That shit up front, nigga. That shit go.
And ain't even no rapper or nothing. Just be sitting there. You ever thought about saying this? And sometimes it don't even be something that you gonna use, but it triggers something else, and it triggers other thoughts in your mind, and you be like, oh, okay, cool, yeah, and you come up with something totally different. Perfect. But it was just that thought that they said that triggered something, a different reaction in your mind to think a different way. So I like it. I don't mind when it's a bunch of people. Some people like, you know, I don't want nobody to be in there. Me, it could be 1,000 people in a room, because when it's time to rap, I zone out. It's like there's nobody in there.
You're going to get that real feedback right now, too. They're going to let you know if it's hot or not.
Absolutely.
I love coming to other niggas' studios and a beat is on. And nigga be like, there'll be 100 niggas in there. I don't care where they from. Nigga, when I walk in the booth, nigga, I'm shutting all you niggas down. It ain't personal, nigga. It's business.
Yeah.
That's what I do, nigga. I'm an MC, nigga. Master of ceremonies, nigga. My job is to slay MCs, nigga. So watch out.
Master of ceremonies. Yeah, that was some deep shit. You're going to be using that in the future.
No, that's the original word for MC. See, you don't even know. I'm a historian. Fuck you talking about I'm going to be using it in the future.
Oh, I didn't even know that. That's the original word? I didn't know that. I thought that I was like, I'm a rapper. I'm sorry. I ain't been rapping in a lot.
It's a loser. Fucking loser.
That's what MC
mean?
Yeah,
niggas, man.
Is crazy,
man. Niggas a loser. I never knew that's what MC meant.
That's why I don't take
it. I thought it was mic controller or some shit. I didn't know it was master of ceremonies. Like, damn, dog, just because that's all you fucking knew growing up. You fucking bootleg Big Daddy Kane.
No, Chuck D.
Oh, Chuck D. Oh,
yeah. Here it out. Is. Bam. And you say, God damn, this is a dope jam. Yes, sir. He on it.
Listen, he already beat you, bro. Tap the fuck out. He already whooped your ass. You still here trying to prove yourself. It's
it
over.
Is what it is.
That's over with. You're not him no more. You're the rest of them. You're not him. He's him.
I'm the one, not the two, and I'm from the old school.
That's what I'm saying. That's what it's going down.
Fuck is wrong with you? And if you ain't know, it's the Snoop D.O.DOUBLE.G, nigga.
Yes, sir. $1 million worth of game. Mm. You better come get you some.
But listen, before we go, I got to give a shout out to my brother from another mother, White Boy Kev.
Yes, sir.
That's my folks.
Absolutely.
Kev will call me 4 a.m. I know you up, Wildo.
Connected dots.
What's going on? I'm making my video right now, Kev.
Hey, like, Kev, I'm jerking off with you.
No, what's up?
I'll call you later on, Wildo. Fuck that.
He never gets me when I was partying, when I was going on a hand date. Yeah, they call them hand dates.
He's like, I'm strangling a monkey right
now. He never called me in that, and it caught me slipping like that.
Can you call me back, Kev?
I'm in
a conversation with Pamela right now.
All right. I got the chicken.
I'm going on a date right now.
I got the chicken and the choco.
I have nightcap. But no, Kev is just a real one, man. He always holding it down. Every time I call, we always having real great talk. Conversations. White
Team
Kev.
Snoop, baby. Team Snoop. We want it.
He ain't playing no games. Kev out here making it happen, man. Taking care of man in any way possible. And that's what it's about, man.
Yes, sir.
Teamwork make the dream work, man.
Better know it.
I mean.
And it's just like that.
Right.